وَإِن تَعْجَبْ فَعَجَبٌ قَوْلُهُمْ أَإِذَا كُنَّا تُرَابًا أَإِنَّا لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ الْأَغْلَالُ فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد. أستاذ عبد الرحمن حسن, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
I thank you once again for joining me on the Hot Seat podcast. بارك الله فيكم.
وفيك بارك الله.
So last week we spoke about the different madhahib fiqhiyah and the different schools of thought when it comes to Islamic jurisprudence and interpreting the Quran and the Sunnah. I actually want to do a very similar thing this week, but instead of looking at fiqh, I want to look at the science of aqeedah, and I want to see how these different, for lack of a better word, schools in aqeedah developed, where they came from, and what are the main tenets of their belief. And to be honest with you, last week we focused on four madhahib, and this week I kind of want to focus on two schools of thought when it comes to aqeedah. The ashaa'ira, who follow the Ash'ari creed, and then the Salafis, which is a position that you're going to be representing today, who follow the Athari creed, or otherwise known as the Hanbali creed in the Aqeedah. As usual, I'm going to give you the introduction, and I have two requests for the introduction and then one condition, which is a new condition I'm bringing to the table today. The first request is that in your introduction, can you please define briefly what Aqeedah means? And the second one is, please, can you go through who are the Asha'ira? Please, those are the two things I'd like you to do in your introduction. And the new condition I'm going to bring to the table today is I'm going to limit you to a 10-minute introduction. I'm going to set a timer. And after 10 minutes, we're going to stop your introduction no matter where you are. And we're going to go into the discussion. The 10 minutes is starting from now.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Lahu alhamdul hasan wa thana'u al-jameel. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. You're asking for something very big in a very short period of time. So al-aqeedah is, in simple terms, it's the six articles of faith. أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره.
Okay.
And there's also other ملحقات, other things that scholars add on to aqeedah, which they've taken from the Quran and the Sunnah, and the unanimous agreement of the Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors, which is the issue of مسمى الإيمان. What does إيمان actually mean? The issue of الإمامة, related to the Muslim leader. How do we deal with the Muslim leader? And other issues like that. Generally speaking, that is what aqeedah is. Again, it's a topic that requires a whole podcast by itself. But you've given me a very short period of time. So in a summarized, brief response, that's what I would say. Mm-hmm. As for the Asha'ira, the Asha'ira, they refer themselves back to a man by the name of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, whose name is Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn Ismail, Abu Bishr, Ishaq ibn Salim, ibn Ismail, ibn Abdullah, ibn Musa, ibn Bilal, who goes back to originally the noble companion Abu Musa al-Ash'ari al-Yamani al-Basri. So that's where he goes back to. This man was born, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, was born when the Islamic calendar was 260. He was born in Basra. And so he's called Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari al-Basri. They call him al-Basri because of where he was born. His father Ismail, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari's father, Ismail, he was from the people of Ahlus-sunnah wal-Jama'ah. And he was a muhaddith, his father, a man who knew the knowledge of hadith. And when his father was passing away, he spoke to a great imam, Zakariya ibn Yahya al-Saji, and said, can you take care of my son, yani educate him and teach him? So Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, he took some ahadiths from Zakariya ibn Yahya al-Saji. Zakariya ibn Yahya al-Saji is a Shafi'i scholar, and is min a'immat al-hadith, and he has many books from them, ikhtilaf al-ulama, and he has a book called ilal al-hadith, and he died 307 rahimahullah. He passed away in Basra. So he sat with him and he took a few number of hadiths. Lakin, it didn't take too long. Yani there was benefits that he was taking. It wasn't something very long. It was only the first 10 years of his life. And then after that, his mother married a man by the name of Abu Ali al-Jubai al-Mu'tazili. Abu Ali al-Jubai al-Mu'tazili is a Mu'tazili, and he was a figurehead of him. So Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari remained with him for the next 30 years of his life. He stayed with this man. And this man changed the view of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. And Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari passed away when it was 320 Hijriah. 320 Hijriah. And some scholars, they say, no, it's 324. And some scholars, they say, no, it's 330 Hijriah. And that seems to be the strongest, which is 330 Hijriah. Ibn Asakir strengthened that opinion. Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, he went through marahil, stages in his life. If you break it down, it's five. And if you bring it together, it's three. So let me take it as five so I can expand on it and explain it in more details. The first marhala of his life is the marhalatu nash'ah. It's when he grew up, it's the one I mentioned, when he was born until the age of 10, where he was studying with the great imam, which I mentioned, Abu Yahya, Zakariya ibn Yahya ibn Abdul Rahman al-Saji al-Basri. He took knowledge from him and he benefited from him. That marhala didn't take too long for him. And it wasn't a long-lasting marhala. It wasn't a long-lasting stage. Which then moves me on to the second marhala, which is when Abu Ali al-Jubai married his mother and he took from him the i'tizal. He became a mu'tazili and he remained in that marhala for the next 30 years. So 40 years, when he was the age of 40, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, he could not stay in this for too long. And he defended the Mu'tazila to a level where he even mentioned it. He said, I authored a book. He mentions it in his Kitab al-Umad. He said, I wrote a book in the Mu'tazili ideology, defending it. No book was written for the Mu'tazila like it. And so he became a master in it. Which then brings us to the third stage of his life where he came back from the Mu'tazila ideology. And there's factors that played from him to leave the Mu'tazili ideology. Some of which are, number one, al-ru'a, a dream that he saw. And this dream, Ibn Asakir mentions it in his Kitab al-Tabiyyin al-Kadhib al-Muftari فيما نسب إلى الإمام أبي الحسن الأشعري. It's a book that he wrote to defend Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. In that book, Ibn Asakir, he mentions that he had a dream that the Prophet, he spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to go towards his sunnah. The Prophet said to him, عليك بسنتي, upon you is my sunnah. So, and that dream is mentioned in many different ways. There's no chain for it. But because it's mentioned in ample books like Tabaqat, Subki brings it his Tabaqat, Qadi Iyad brings it in his Tartib al-Madarik, and also Ibn Asakir mentions it, it seems to be something that has basis.
Okay.
The second reason why he left the Mu'tazili belief was that he had a debate with his uncle or his stepfather. Debated on issues related to is the name Aqil, is that a name from the names of Allah? Another mas'ala known as As-Salah wal-Aslah. And issues like this they debated. And Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari felt that Abu Ali al-Jubai was not grounded enough in these issues and he had no good answers. So he left him and he abandoned him. And then he turned away from that. Another third factor they say that he left Mu'tazila was because Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, according to the strongest opinion, he is a Shafi'i in Madhab. So Al-Imam Shafi'i, as it's known, his position regarding Ilm al-Kalam is very well known. Shafi'i said, my ruling hukmi ala ahli al-Kalam is an yudraba bil jarid wal ni'al. Shafi'i said, my ruling on the people of Ilm al-Kalam is that they get lashed with branches, tree branches is taken and they're lashed, and shoes, and they're paraded in the market. And then they told, هذا جزاء من أعرض عن الكتاب والسنة وأقبل على علم الكلام. That's the ruling of the person who turns away from the Qur'an and the Sunnah and turns towards علم الكلام And Shafi'i had a very strong position regarding ilm al-kalam. He even debated Bishr al-Marisi, al-Anid. He debated also Hafs al-Fard. So Shafi'i didn't like ilm al-kalam, and he used to refer to the science as anyone who learns it would turn into, it's a part of heresy, zandaqa. So Abul Hasan al-Ash'ari is saying, I'm following Shafi'i in furu' al-fiqhiyya. I'm a Shafi'i in fiqh, but I am Mu'tazili in Mu'taqad. And Shafi'i was against the Mu'tazila. He couldn't reconcile between the two, so he left it. And that's one of the reasons that are mentioned. Those reasons are also one of the reasons that contributed for him to leave the Mu'tazila. Now I come to the fourth stage, which is the Marhalatul Ash'ariyah, where he became an Ash'ari. This Marhala is when he took on the ideology of Abi Muhammad Abdullah ibn Sa'id ibn Kullab. He took the belief of Ibn Kullab, and he started to refute the Mu'tazila. And when he refuted the Mu'tazila, he wrote a book called Al-Luma' fi al-Raddi ala Ahli Zayghi wal-Bida', and he wrote many, many other books refuting the Mu'tazila. And he would be the best person for the job, because he was one of them for 40 years, so he would know their ins and outs. So he went out to refute them. And the last and final stage is the stage where he repented from that, and he came to the Mu'taqad and the belief of Ahlus-sunnah wal-Jama'ah. But the strongest opinion is that when he did leave the tariqah of Ibn Kullab, which is the path today, the Asha'ira, when they say we are Ash'aris, they're referring to that fourth stage I was speaking about, which is Marhalatul Ash'ariyah, when he was in, Ibn Kullab's path. They're referring to that stage, the Asha'ira today. This last stage to the Asha'ira is, it doesn't exist. They don't like it.
Okay.
They don't believe in it when it really is a reality. Ibn Kathir mentions it, rahimahullah ta'ala, and it's a reality documented. His works have been quoted by Ribana, it's been quoted by Ibn Asakir and others. Ala kulli hal, this stage, even though he repented from that path and he became, in general, became from Ahlul Sunnah, still Ibn Kulab's ideology was still present with him. Now, I want to speak about, it's a very big topic, you've given me a very short period of time. What I want to say, inshallah ta'ala, is that Abul Hasan al-Ash'ari,
we're out of time. We're going to go into it, I'm sure, but I can't give you any more time because I laid that condition at the start. Okay, so what I got from that is that you're talking about a man, the one who was the founder, for lack of a better word, of the Sha'ara, the madhab of the Ash'aris. And he originally was taken from a Shafi'i scholar from Ahlul Sunnah. And then he went through different stages, and it was like the second stage where he took the Mu'tazili belief, and then he tried to actually oppose the Mu'tazila, and that's where the stage came from, this Ash'ari belief that you're referring to today. What is a summary of that kind of belief that you're going to be talking about today?
This belief is detailed. It's really detailed, and inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to respond to it in great details, and I'm going to, but can I just mention four figures? And I think it's very important. I'll let you. There's four men, I believe, that play a big role in the tatawur and the tahawul, tatawurat and the tahawulat of the madhab al-Ash'ari. Okay. If these four figures are not looked at, you don't really understand Ash'ariyah. As we know, Abul Hasan al-Ash'ari, he diverted from the path of Ahlul Sunnah wal-Jama'ah when he was upon the path of Ibn Kullab. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to prove the way that's the case. But then every man who came added more deviation onto the issue. For example, Abu Bakr al-Baqillani is the first person I want to mention. Four people, but I mentioned Abu Bakr al-Baqillani, number one.
Okay.
And this is all in order. Abu Bakr al-Baqillani, he placed foundations, ta'sis al-aqli. He's the first person who put down logical arguments for the madhab. And he made what you would call a content page of a book.
Okay.
Yeah, and he gave the headings and he left it that way. Then Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni came. Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni came so close to the Mu'tazila. Initially, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari was refuting the Mu'tazila. In the Kitab al-Luma', he was refuting it. Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni, when he came, he got closer to the Ash'ariya. Okay? So the Mu'tazila. And he basically weakened the arguments of the Ash'ara against the Mu'tazila. And he wrote a kitab called Al-Irshad ila Qawati' al-Adillah. He wrote another kitab called Al-Shamil fi Usul al-Din. If you compare Abi Ma'al al-Juwayni to Abu Bakr al-Baqillani, you see a big difference between the two of them.
Okay.
For example, if you read the kitab Tamheed al-Awa'il wa Talqis al-Dala'il, it's shocking because the tab'at has been, like, two tab'ats have come out. One is not complete and the other one was complete. What they did was, subhanAllah, is that Abu Bakr al-Baqilani affirms Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is above his throne. Imagine okay. that. Okay. And he refutes those people who do ta'wil of it. Abu Bakr al-Baqilani.
Ta'wil meaning?
Anyone who distorts the meaning.
Okay.
He proves Allah is above his throne. That's Abu Bakr al-Baqilani. Now pay attention to that. Abu Bakr al-Baqilani proves this and he debunks the arguments of those who say otherwise.
Okay, fine.
Now, if you look at the taba'at that have come out after that, Tamheed al-Awail wa Talqis al-Dala'il, you see that they took that part chapter out. Which brings me to a point later, I'm going to prove what type of people the Asha'ira are and their mindset and how deceptive they are. I'll prove it to you, inshallah ta'ala. Mm-hmm. Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni denies the name and sorry, Allah being above his throne. He's now going okay. against the Abu Bakr al-Baqilani. So he wrote a kitab called Al-Irshad ila Qawat al-Adillah, Shamil ila Usul al-Din. Then came up the third person, which is Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, who's a student of Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni. So I just mentioned Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni, what did he do? He became so close to the Mu'tazila, which the Sha'ira were known to refute and speak against.
Okay, fine.
Abu Ma'al al-Juwayni comes, brings, he gets Sha'ira close to the Mu'tazila. Then Abu Hamid al-Ghazali comes, and then what he does is he does between the Tasawwuf and the Ash'ariyah, which wasn't present before. He brings the Sufis to the Ash'ariyah. So then after Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, you don't find an Ash'ari except he's a Sufi. And then he was the first person to place قانون التعارض بين العقل والنقل, that there is a contradiction between the text and the logic. So he wrote his kitab al-Iqtisad fi al-I'tiqad. He wrote a kitab called Tahafut al-Falasifa, and he wrote another kitab called قانون التأويل. He just put down the argument that there could be a contradiction between the text and the logic and the reasoning. Fakhruddin al-Razi, the fourth individual, comes. Fakhruddin al-Razi picked up from where Abu Hamid al-Ghazali left off. He picked up from there and he wrote a kitab called Ta'sis al-Taqdis, which is also known as Ta'sis al-Taqdis, where Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah took it upon himself to refute him in four lines what he said about the issue of Qanun al-Kulli. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah wrote his kitab Dar al-Ta'arud al-Aql wal-Naql, where he refuted him. He also has another kitab called Ma'alimi Usul al-Din. These four men are the horsemen of the madhab of the Asha'ira. You have to know these men. If you don't know these men, you don't know the Asha'ira.
And what you're saying is that they changed the madhab over time. The Ash'ari madhab actually changed over time. It took different forms. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
And okay, that's fine. Understood. There's no issue with that. I don't understand why that seems to be a problem in your mind. We discussed last week about the madhab in fiqh also changing, and that wasn't an issue for you at all. Like the raj and marjuh is going to change over time. What's the issue with that?
So it's not an issue in the sense, I just want people to understand the historical development of the Ash'ari madhab. This is a madhab that's not concrete. It's a problem here right now.
So all the madhab in fiqh aren't concrete that change over time?
No, I'm going to come to the issue. Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, what he said is not what Fakhruddin al-Razi is saying
okay.
in creedal issues. First of all, we shouldn't conflate between Aqeedah and Fiqh. Let me give you something. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, in the tarjama of Imam al-Shafi'i, Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, Dhahabi, he speaks about the biography of Imam al-Shafi'i. In there, he brings the sanad of Az-Zubayr ibn Abdullah, Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Wahid, where he said, Akhbarani Ali ibn Muhammad in Egypt, حدثنا محمد بن عبد الله بن عبد الحكم. He said, كان الشافعي, الإمام الشافعي, كان الشافعي بعد أن ناظر حفص الفرد. When Shafi'i debated with this man, حفص الفرد, he disliked the علم الكلام. He disliked it. يكره علم الكلام.
Sorry, it's the second or third time you mentioned that. What is علم الكلام?
علم الكلام, it's Greek philosophy.
Okay, fine.
They took Aristotle arguments, they took Plato's arguments, and then they used that to understand Aqeedah. So they were saying, the way Usul al-Fiqh is for Fiqh, they were saying Ilm al-Kalam is for Aqeedah.
Okay.
The great scholars of Al-Islam denied that, refuted that, debunked that. Abu Mudhafar al-Sam'an is a nice statement on that, which Imam Qawam al-Sunnah, Abu Qasim al-Taymi, brings in his kitab al-Hujjah fi Bayan al-Mahajjah. And Ismail al-Harawi has a kitab called Dhamm al-Kalam wa Ahlihi. Anyways, Shafi'i debated a man called Hafs al-Fard. when he debated him, Shafi'i said something very powerful. He said, Wallahi, la'an yufti al-alim fayuqalu akhta' al-alim khayrun lahu. For a scholar to give a fatwa and get it wrong is better for him than to do a what? To speak in ilm al-kalam, use ilm al-kalam, min an yatakallama fayuqalu zindiqun, to be said that he is a zindiq, a heretic individual. Pay attention.
What does he mean by that?
A person is speaking in fiqh, he gets it wrong, he's either going to get two rewards or one reward. He uses usul al-fiqh, he speaks about it, he's an alim, he's the right person for it. He's one or two rewards. If he gets it right, he gets two reward, and if he gets it wrong, he gets what?
One reward.
He said that's better for him, to get it wrong and just leave with one reward, because the scholars, they didn't want to get it wrong. They wanted to get it right. That's what they were trying their hardest to get it right. Shafi'i is saying, for a person to give fatwa in an issue, and it's just between one or two rewards, is better for him than to speak with ilmul kalam, and what is between is what? Zindiq, kafir, and a Muslim. Then look what he said, وَمَا شَيْءٌ أَبْغَضُ إِلَيَّ مِنْ عِلْمِ الْكَلَامِ وَأَهْلِ. Shafi'i said, I hate the most hated people to me, Shafi'i is saying, are the people of kalam. Now, Zahabi took something from this. He said, هَذَا دَالٌ. This statement of Shafi'i shows أَنَّ مَذْهَبَ أَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ, that the methodology of Al-Imam Shafi'i is أَنَّ الْخَطَأَ فِي الْأُصُولِ, to do a mistake in aqeedah, لَيْسَ كَالْخَطَأِ فِي الْإِجْتِهَادِ فِي الْفُرُوعِ, is not like doing a mistake in an issue of fiqh.
So that's Zahabi's mafhum, that's his understanding. We have the same in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that the mujtahid is it between one or two rewards.
When you say Zahabi is mafhum, we need to find someone who's either the same level of al-Imam with Zahabi, someone who is of the caliber of al-Imam with Zahabi, who we can say said otherwise.
So who is the Imam Zahabi? Who gives him the right to restrict a general statement of the
Messenger? Who gives anyone the rights who's lower than Zahabi to disagree with him? Who's lower and weaker in understanding? Yani,
the asal is that it's a general statement that the alim is between them.
No, Shafi'i said
rewards,
Shafi'i.
One or two rewards. In aqeedah or fiqh. So why now you restrict that to only fiqh?
The religion, by the way, this is something I need to clear for many people. Okay. They confuse. Furu' and usul. This is what we're dividing it into. Don't use the word aqeedah and fiqh here necessarily, because in aqeedah there are issues which are furu'. And in aqeedah, the bulk of aqeedah are usul.
Okay.
Yani fundamental issues. Within aqeedah, there are issues which are furu', which you might find great scholars disagree with. Not scholars, but differences here or there on some small issues. We don't say they have difference in aqeedah. Because once you say aqeedah, the overwhelming majority of aqeedah is usul. So when you say aqeedah, it will fall to that. So what do you say?
Usul.
The same way you can't say they all agreed on fiqh, because the majority of fiqh is furu'. Do you see my point?
Yeah.
So here what we say is that anyone who goes against Ahlus-sunnah in issues which are usul, like issue of fiqh, which is usul, is like dhuhr is wajib. Can someone say, I believe dhuhr is not wajib? Even though it's an issue of fiqh.
Is that not an aqeedah issue as well?
No, it's not.
Okay.
The issue of dhuhr being wajib is what you study in books of fiqh.
Okay.
Okay. That these are the five obligatory prayers. Yani, what is wajib? What is mustahab? What is, you know, mubah, what is makruh, what is haram? You study that in usul al-fiqh and fiqh. But it's also a fundamental issue. It's a fundamental issue. You know, somebody comes and says, I don't believe dhuhr is wajib, I don't believe asr is wajib, I don't believe all these salahs are wajib. That's disbelief. Okay? That's disbelief.
Okay.
The same with issues of aqeedah. You can't go against, because these are issues which have been unanimously agreed upon. There's no difference of opinion on these issues. There's ijma' on these issues. That's what Dhahabi is trying to say here, that Shafi'i is saying, هَذَا دَالٌ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ مَذْهَبَ أَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ أَنَّ الْخَطَأَ فِي الْأُصُولِ, a mistake in usul, لَيْسَ كَالْخَطَأِ فِي الْإِجْتِهَادِ فِي الْفُرُوعِ. And I like how Dhahabi is precise in what he said. He said, لَيْسَ كَالْخَطَأِ فِي الْإِجْتِهَادِ فِي الْفُرُوعِ, الْإِجْتِهَادِ فِي الْفُرُوعِ. So there's ijtihad and there's khilaaf. These two things have to be really understood. Khilaf means differences. And we have differences with Christians. We have differences with Jews. We have differences with Buddhists. We have differences with the Jahmiya. We have differences with the Mu'tazila. These are differences. Ijtihad is what? It's a type of difference. It's the accepted type of difference. It's the difference where you call it ikhtilafun sa'iqun.
Okay, this is where the discussion revolves around. What determines whether it's ijtihad or ikhtilaf? Like
anything, there is a Qur'an, sunnah, and there's ijma' on it. So the Qur'an and the sunnah and the understanding of these two have been restricted by consensus.
And so then you can't go against that?
No, you can't. If the Quran says something and the Sunnah says something and the Ummah have unanimously agreed upon that this is one interpretation of this issue, no one is allowed to come and give it this is now you have to stop. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Anyone who goes, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ, anyone who goes against the Prophet, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى, after clear cut evidence has come to him, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ أَنِي فَلَوْزْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, a path other than the path of the believers, يعني the إجماع of the Ummah. Allah says نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى, whatever path you've chosen is what Allah is going to forsake you on, and that's going to be a very bad path for you. Allah mentions نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ, and Jahannam is going to be your final abode, وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. And then the books of Aqeedah that you open, what you're reading is ijma'. When they say madhhabu salaf, ay ajma'a salaf, the salaf agreed upon these issues. Look at the kitab Aqeedatul Raziyin, at the beginning when he mentions it. He says this is the aqeedah of the Ahlul Amsar, the belief of all of the Muslims. So let's
get to the crux of the issue now between the Asha'ira and the Athari or the Salafis or however you want to call it.
So can I define who Ahlus-sunnah, so we have an understanding of it?
So, okay, you can, but before I allow you to do that, you're saying Ahlus-sunnah are not the Asha'ira, because the Asha'ira call themselves Ahlus-sunnah as well.
Look, before we that's a second, I want to be fair here. Okay. I don't want to jump to saying that they are Asha'ira or not.
Let's want to lay the definition.
Let's look at Asha'ira. Let's look at Ahlus-sunnah, okay, the definition for it. And then we look at what Asha'ira believe, and then we can compare the two. Do they fall against under Ahlus-sunnah? Ahlus-sunnah, who are they? Ahlus-sunnah are, as Qawam al-Sunnah mentioned, he said,
who's Qawam al-Sunnah?
He's an imam in A'imat al-Salaf, early imam of the Salaf.
What the name?
Qawam al-Sunnah, Abu al-Qasim, al-Taymi al-Asbahani. He has a kitab called Al-Hujjah fi Bayan al-Mahajja. By the way, the kitab again is an Aqeedah book, and he's talking about the consensus. He's not talking about a few group of Hanabila believe this, or a group of the Shafi'iyah believe this, or a group of the Malikiyah believe this, or the Hanafiyah. This is an imam who wrote his book based on the unanimous agreement of the imams of his statement. Similar to it, you can find it in Sharh al-Sunnah li-Imam Abu Qasim Hibatullah al-Alakai Usul I'tiqad al-Sunnah al-Jama'ah. You can also find Aqeedah al-Salaf Ashab al-Hadith by Sabuni. You can find I'tiqad al-Aimat al-Hadith by Abu Bakr al-Ismaili. You can also find it in the kitab Al-Wasatiyah by Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. And all of these books I'm saying are all based on unanimous agreements, not difference of opinion and a fringe of people hold this view.
Because you understand that the Asha'ira will also bring ulama and bring names, and they talk about this person. It's like your scholar against his scholar. What's the difference?
This definition I'm going to give, walillah alhamdu wal minna, they're not going to disagree with it.
Okay, fine.
But inda nuzul al maidan, as the scholars say, when we come down to the points and we look at each point, then we find sarat musharriqatin wa sirta mugharribin fashattana bayna musharriqin wa mugharribi. They are on the east and the issue is on the west. The distance between the east and the west is very far from each other. Qawam al-Sunnah Abu Qasim al-Taymiyyah, he says in his kitab al-Hujjah fi Bayan al-Mahajjah, he says qawluhum, when the scholars say fulanun ala sunnah wa min ahli sunnah, when they say that, it means muwafiqun lit-tanzili, he's in line with the revelation, wal athar and ahadith, fil fi'li wal qawli, in his speech and his actions, li anna as-sunnah la takunu ma'a mukhalafati Allah wa mukhalafati rasulihi, can't be from the people of the Sunnah whilst you're opposing Allah and His Messenger. Is that something anyone's going to disagree with?
No, that's
Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, again, someone who's neutral, they like, they admire. He mentions in his kitab Jami' Ulum al-Hikam, he says, وَالسُنَّةِ, it means هِيَ الطَّرِيقُ الْمَسْلُوكِ, Sunnah means a path you take. Sunnah, that's what it means. It's the path that you take. فَيَشْمَلُ ذَلِكَ التَّمَسُكِ بِمَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ هُوَ. So sunnah involves, sunnah means to hold on to that which the Prophet was holding on to. وَخُلَفَاءُهُ الرَّاشِدُونَ, and his four rightly guided khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali, مِنَ الْإِعْتِقَادَاتِ, their beliefs, وَالْأَعْمَالِ, and their actions, وَالْأَقْوَالِ, and their statements, وَهَذِهِ هِيَ السُنَّةِ كَامِلَةً, this is the complete reality of the sunnah. Then the sunnah is the Prophet and the four rightly guided khulafa, in their speech, in their belief, and in their actions. Okay. Is that something a person can deny?
No, that's perfectly fair.
That's fair to say that this is it. Allah says in the Quran, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم. Follow that which has come to you from your Lord. ولا تتبعوا and do not follow من دونه أولياء anyone besides Allah. قليلا ما تذكرون. يعني the first person we need to follow is Allah. If anyone or any individual is in opposition to Allah and His Messenger, what do we do? We dismiss them and we go to Allah and His Messenger. صح؟ الإمام القرطبي said something very powerful in the tafsir of this verse. He said, وكل من رضي مذهبا. Anyone who's pleased with a madhab, a view, a methodology, a school of thought. فأهل ذلك المذهب أولياءه. You are, that madhab is your awliya. You've chosen other. If it's in line with Allah and His Messenger, fine, no problem. Ibn Kathir رحمه الله, when he came to the ayat, تبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم, what did he say? اقتفوا آثار النبي الأمي الذي جاءكم بكتاب أنزل إليكم من ربكم من رب كل شيء ومليكي. He said, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم means follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the illiterate one. That the one that came to you with the book that you have, the Quran. Allah also says, وَسَابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُونَ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. We have a final point I want to mention is that we have the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, or one specific hadith which is called hadith al-iftiraq, which many people know, the hadith of the division. Hadith Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. Abu Dawud narrated it, Ahmad narrated it, Ibn Hajar authenticated it, Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah authenticated it, where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned, أَلَا إِنَّ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ افْتَرَقُوا. The people of the scripture that came before you divided. عَلَى ثِنْتَيْنِ وَسَبْعِينَ مِلَّةٍ. They broke into how many? 72 groups. وَإِنَّ هَذِهِ الْمِلَّةِ. This group. سَتَفْتَرِقُ عَلَى ثَلَاثٍ وَسَبْعِينَ. They're going to break into and divide into 73. ثِنْتَانِ وَسَبْعُونَ فِي النَّارِ. 72 are in the hellfire. Shahid, ponder here. It's not an issue of fiqh now. How can all of them go to the hellfire if it's an issue of valid difference of opinion? The Prophet is saying,
but that's fine, but that doesn't mean the one group, within the one group, the safe sect, as you call it, doesn't mean that the Asha'ira and
I haven't gone to whether Asha'ira are,
but that group could be big with differences of opinion, with small difference of opinion in there.
Do you think, but do you, this is the point I want even the people watching to really ask themselves this question. The Prophet is saying 72 are going to be in the hellfire.
Yeah.
By the way, the 72 are not disbelievers.
Yeah,
they're Muslims.
No problem.
So it's not like when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, "Wa inna hadhihi al-milla, wa inna ummati, my ummah." He means ummatu al-ijaba, the ones who accepted his message as a prophet.
Yeah, no problem.
So they're Muslims. So 72 of those groups are going to be in the hellfire. So they're not 72 people who differed with the Prophet in an issue of fiqh.
Okay.
Because an issue of fiqh, you don't go to the hellfire for it. This is a fundamental issue, something that is not tolerated. Then the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned the 73 groups. 72 of them are going to be in the hellfire and only one group is going to go to Jannah. He then gave us who this group is. He didn't say, Abdurrahman, it's you. All the Somalis are that one group. He didn't say that. He didn't say, oh, the people from subcontinent, you guys are that one group. He didn't say, Arabs, you guys are that one group that's going to be saved. He didn't say, Europeans, you are that one saved group. He didn't. He gave a description. If you come with it, wherever in the world you are, inshallah ta'ala, you don't need to sign a paper, you don't need to give pledge of allegiance to a particular individual or organization. You don't have to. Just one characteristic that's needed from you, which is ma ana alayhi wa ashabi, whatever me and my companions are upon. Then Qawam al-Sunnah statement that I mentioned, and Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali is in line with those verses I mentioned and the hadith that I just mentioned now. That Ahlus-sunnah are who? They are the ones who take the Quran and the Sunnah, and they also take what? The Sahabas.
Okay.
The Prophet said that, right? So we want to be from that one group.
That's fair.
Now, let's look at the Asha'ira. Is it fair for us to now look at the Asha'ira, what they believe when it comes to following the Quran and Sunnah? I don't want to quote other people. I'm going to quote them.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm going to allow you to do that. But I want you to understand one thing. Like we spoke about last time, that the madhahib in fiqh, and I understand your point that it's different between fiqh and aqeedah, no problem. The madhahib in fiqh, they were humans who were attempting to understand the Quran, the Sunnah, and the companions. In aqeedah, these are also human attempts to try and understand the Quran, Sunnah, and the companions.
No,
you might disagree with them. They might get it wrong. You might say this goes against the Quran, but it's their interpretation.
No,
of Quran.
Shahi, that's my point. And what I'm saying to you is that these issues have unanimously been agreed upon.
Okay, let's speak about one of these issues. What are you talking about?
So that's what I want to go through, a few points, and then show you. Right now, do we all agree And every Muslim would agree the Quran and the Sunnah and the Sahabas is the way forward.
Sah? Yes, yeah, yeah.
Ashaa'ira don't agree with that.
They do.
Okay, let me quote their imams.
Okay, go on.
Why?
You know, I don't understand. They come out openly and say that they do.
Ah, they don't know. They say they don't. Listen to this. They're going to talk. I'm going to bring their references and their statements.
From the Mutaakhirin?
I'm going to bring those four horsemen I mentioned. And I'm going to mention other people. Anyone I mention from the Ashaa'ira is not someone they're going to deny.
Okay, go on.
I'm mentioning bona fide people in their field to show you that these people, the differences with us is a fundamental issue. And I'm going to prove today, inshallah ta'ala, that the Ashaa'ira today, the Ashaa'ira that we know today, are not Ashaa'ira of the early way of Abul Hasan Ash'ari. The Ashaa'ira of today are Jahmiyya Mahab. They are Jahmiyya. They are the Jahmiyya that Ahmad ibn Hanbal spoke against, that Imam al-Shafi'i spoke against, and the great scholars of Islam spoke against. And I'm not going to prove it from what Ibn Taymiyyah said about them or what Ibn Qayyim said about them. Or I'm going to prove it from what they said about themselves and what they mentioned in their creedal books.
I'll be surprised if today you can prove that, because everybody knows the Shia, for example, they go against those three things. They go against the companions, for example, okay, very, very clearly and openly.
Okay.
But the Ashaa'ira and the mainstream Sunni Islam, they all agree with those three things. So how are you going to prove it?
Look at Fakhruddin al-Razi. Fakhruddin al-Razi. I want everybody to open their minds. If you're listening, write this down. If you think I'm go to it yourself, check it out. He has a kitab called Ta'sis al-Taqdis. There's a book called Ta'sis al-Taqdis. I mentioned that before. It's the kitab Ibn Taymiyyah refuted him in his Zar'u Ta'arud al-Aqli wal-Naqli. Go to page 172. He says, I'lam know anna dala'il al-qat'iyyah al-aqliyyah. Pardon here, step by step. He says, know that the clear logical evidences, first, so clear cut logical arguments.
Okay.
إِذَا قَامَتْ عَلَىٰ ثُبُوتِ شَيْءٍ, if it proves the reality of something and that something is firm, and if the aql says this is what this is. Again, he referred to the aql as what? الْقَطْعِيَّةُ الْعَقْلِيَّةُ الدَّلَائِلُ الْقَطْعِيَّةُ الْعَقْلِيَّةُ. The aql is number one, قَطْعِيَّة, clear cut. And it's also, if it proves the reality of something and it affirms something, the aql affirms something. ثُمَّ وَجَدْنَا, then we find أَدِلَّ النَّقْلِيَّةِ, and then we find a textual evidences. يُشْعِرُ بِخِلَافِ ذَلِكَ, that opposes that logic. That what my the dala'il al-qat'i al-aqliyya. He says, فَهَاهُنَا لَا يَقْلُ الْحَالُ مِنْ أَحَدِ أُمُورٍ أَرْبَعَ. Four situations we have to deal with this issue.
Mm-hmm.
Shahid, please listen. He's going to tell us. He's saying that the aql and the naql are contradicting one another.
Okay.
The aql said yes and the naql said no.
Okay.
He's saying, what do we do here? Four steps. The first step is, إِمَّا أَن نُصَدِّقَ مُقْتَضَ الْعَقْلِ وَالنَّقْلِ فَيَلْزَمُ تَصْدِيقَ النَّقِيضَيْنِ وَهُوَ مُحَالٌ. We take both of them. And he says, two opposites cannot be taken. That's an illogical absurdity.
Fine.
Okay, number one, let's go. Number two, وَإِمَّا أَن نُبْطِلَهُمَا. The second one is that we reject both of them. We say we don't take the aql or the naql. He says, فَيَلْزَمُ تَكْذِيبَ النَّقِيضَيْنِ. That means we would reject the two opposites, which also is an illogical absurdity, because we're going to be forced to do one in reality. Let's also get rid of that. How many options are we left with?
Two.
Two more. The third option, he says, is وَإِمَّا أَن نُصَدِّقَ الظَّوَاهِرَ النَّقْلِيَّةِ, that we take the clear-cut textual evidences. What do we do? نُكَذِّبُ الظَّوَاهِرَ الْعَقْلِيَّةِ, and we disbelieve in our logic. وَذَلِكَ بَاطِلٌ.
Okay. What's the issue here?
Pardon here. I'm going to mention the fourth option that he brings. Repeat it again. The aql and the naql are contradicting one another. Fakhruddin al-Razi said, we can't take both of them. That's an illogical absurdity. Mm-hmm. Second option, he said that we disbelieve in both of them. And he said it was also a illogical absurdity. The third option is we take the textual evidences and we ignore the logical arguments. And he said, وَذَلِكَ بَاطِلٌ. That's batil, null and void. We can't do that. We can't give precedence to the text over the logic. We can't.
Okay.
The fourth option, he said, is what? The fourth option is we take the adilla al-aqliyyah. We take the what? the aql, and the dillatul aqliya, we take over the naqliya. And he said, we take the adilla al aqliya over adillatul aqliya, we take it over the adilla al naqliya. How do we do that? The text is still standing in front of us.
Okay.
So we took the aql, we're going to take the aql, he said, or we're going to dismiss the naql. But what are we going to do with the naql? He said, what we do with the naql is the following. Either we say, innaha ghayru sahiha, it's weak. And if we still can't, it's really one of those ones, Bukhari or Muslim narrated it. Oh, in kanat sahihatan, but it's sahih and there's no way to disprove it sahih. What do? We refer to back to by saying, illa anna al-murada minha ghayru zahiriha. The intent is not the apparent meaning. Thumma in jawazna ta'wila. We go to distort the meaning. We play around with the meaning. We can't. Wa illam yujizu ta'wila. Ta'wil does not seem to be working for us. Fawadna al-ilma biha ila Allah. We do tafweed, which is another maslak. We say Allah knows what it means. Ponder here, Shahid. What is it that they did? Fakhruddin al-Razi gave precedence to that logic over the text.
Fine.
And with that premise, he comes to the Quran and the Sunnah. So he's going to believe what the Aql has affirmed. When he looks at the Quran and the Sunnah, the Aql won't move for anyone. The Aql is going to stand still. The Aql is going to be the Ra'is. These texts, they're going to be distorted and they're going to be either ignored and said, Allah and His Messenger just read letters for us. We don't know what it means. So when you see them interpret verses to a meaning that you're thinking, this is what they came to, it's not because they believe the Quran and the Sunnah to be a source of legislation.
Well, let's go back a step. Because what part of that in your mind goes against the Quran?
The Quran takes precedence over our aql.
The Quran tells you to use your aql. That's the bit you're misunderstanding.
The argument, Shahid, is not whether we use our aql or not. It's the concept that the aql, first of all, the Quran and the Sunnah, this Quran and Sunnah do not go against the sound mind. That's number one. That premise itself is an illogical absurdity. Ibn Taymiyyah refutes him on that issue and proves him wrong on that issue. That a sound mind does not go against authentic evidence. That doesn't happen.
I mean, that's disputable. Obviously, it can. There are some things that
Ibn Taymiyyah said,
can't
show us. But the thing with these people, I want you to understand, is that the aql to them has no restriction. We believe the aql has restriction, just like your eyesight has restriction. If I switch off the light in this room, you can't actually see.
So I'll give you an example. You believe Allah descends to the lowest heaven. Is that correct? Last third of the night.
You believe Allah mentioned, yanzilu rabbat fi thuluthil layl akhir.
In the last third of the night.
The Prophet said that Allah Azza wa Jalla descends the last third of the night.
It is the last third night everywhere in the world at some point in the time. Agreed?
You see, what happened right now is the minute you heard these characteristics, you started to, logically try to. See, these people who distort Allah's names and attributes, Shahid, they accuse us of being mushabbiha. You're making Allah similar to His creation, correct?
Mm-hmm.
But the truth of the matter is, as the poets, as the Arabs say, رَمَتْنِي بِدَائِهَا وَانْسَلَّتْ. You're accusing me of what you have. They're the ones that when they saw these characteristics in their mind straight away, tashbih came to their mind. And then they want to fight with what's come to their mind.
Okay.
And by fighting that, what do? They go to ta'til, distort the meaning.
And we're going to go into...
And then they go back to tashbih, by the way, again.
And we're going to go into this in a lot more detail next week, where we're going to go into the names and attributes of Allah. But I just want to fix this example, because you haven't answered my question.
No, but Shahid,
what's
happening here is that, this is the point I really want many brothers who... يعني تحكوا أشاعرة, talk to أشاعرة, debate with أشاعرة, prove them wrong. I just want them to understand one thing. أشاعرة is not an ayah that they've just happened to misunderstand it. They've interpreted it in that way. It's not. ظواهر النصوص, the textual evidences, is not a proof to these people. Let me give you another statement.
I don't want you to move from this, because I want you to understand something, because you're looking at it from your perspective, and I can understand where you're looking at it, but I want you to understand the other person's perspective. When you hear about the Allah descends to lows, you say, and someone asks you, how does he do it? You say, Allahu A'lam, we don't. You have just done what Fakhruddin al-Razi is exactly saying.
What did I say?
The aql doesn't understand, so we make tafweed. We say, Allahu A'lam. You say the same thing with the kayfiyah. Your aql can't understand the kayfiyah, the howness. Mm-hmm. So you make tafweed.
Allah told us subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. Again, I'm not choosing to what I want to believe and what I want to do tafweed.
Neither are they. They don't say they're choosing.
Yes, they are.
That's your claim on them.
No. Shahid, ashaa'ira, they came to the Allah's names and attributes it was something else they were discussing. And this is where it led to after that. In other words, ashaa'ira were trying to prove Allah's existence. Originally, the discussion with these people, the Mu'tazila, these people originally, al-mutakallimin, not just ashaa'ira, but the mutakallimin in general, they were trying to prove Allah's existence, wujudullah. And they fell into an issue they called dalilul a'rad wa huduth al-ajsam. To prove Allah's existence, we have to prove Allah is qadim.
Meaning?
That Allah tabarak always has existed.
Okay.
From that moment onwards, to prove Allah's existence trickled down to the names and attributes of Allah. Because they've already placed an argument to prove Allah's existence. Once they've done that, and I don't want to now go to dalil al-a'rad wa huduth al-ajsam, maybe if we go to the issue of asma' wa sifat, the podcast, we might talk about it there, inshallah ta'ala. Lakin, they have this point that they want to prove Allah exists. Now that they've proven...
Which is a good thing.
I mean, it's good that...
It's not a bad thing. Like, you're making it look like it's a bad thing.
No, not in the way they proved it, no.
It's a good thing to want to prove that Allah exists.
But the Christians, the Jews do that as well. The point I'm trying to come to is that, it's how you do it. It's not necessarily what you... The the mutakallimin, when they fell into this warata, they said... These characteristics are a'rad. These characteristics, if we affirm them for Allah and they're happening, that means Allah tabarak wa ta'ala didn't exist necessarily. Which is again, dalil a'rad wa hudud al-ajsam. I don't want to really go into it. It's detailed. Once they believed an argument they said, they got these verses. الرحمن على العرش استوى يو ويبقى وجه ربك ذي الجلال والإكرام يو وجاء ربك والملك صفا صفا وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة. يعني these آيات الصفات came up, scratched their heads and they said وكل نص أوهم التشبيه أوله أو وكل نص أوهم التشبيه أوله أو فوض ورم تنزيها. Any characteristic that comes to you, do تأويل or تفويض of it. يعني it's not just a one-off situation where they misunderstood or they held on to a hadith which was weak. Or this is an idea that comes from the logic is the asal. And the nusus al-wahyayn are furu'.
Do you not think that they're actually holding on to an ayah?
No, they're not. No, that's not.
And that's what makes them do this.
No.
It's just
I wish that was the case. No, it's not.
And it's the same as the Madhahib Fiqh.
Let me give you more. Sunusi is one of the great books they study. His kitab, he's got a kitab called Sharh al-Kubra. He mentions, he says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ زَعَمَ أَنَّ الطَّرِيقَ إِلَى مَعْرِفَةِ الْحَقِّ. Anyone who claims the path to know the truth is al-kitab wa-sunnah. Anyone who claims the path to know the truth is the kitab and the sunnah. وَيَحْرُمُ أَنِ it is haram مَا سِوَاهُمَا any other ways فَالرَّدُّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ حُجِّيَتَهُمَا لَا تُعْرَفُ إِلَّا بِالنَّظَرِ الْعَقْلِ. The refutation on him is, and he's going to refute a person who said the way to know the truth and to know what is haq is the kitab and the sunnah. He said that, and it's not allowed for you to look at any other thing. Like Shafi'i said, don't look at ilmul kalam. They believe if you don't look at ilmul kalam, you can't know the truth. That's the asal. So he's saying here, anyone who claims that the way to know the truth is the kitab and the sunnah, the refutation on this person is the following. Ya Rajul, Shahid, if imagine I said this to you. They believe it's min usul al-kufri. It's disbelief of Allah to say I'm going to hold on to the Quran and Sunnah.
They don't mean it like that. That's
Shahid,
the thing.
No,
how do you know the truthfulness of the Quran and Sunnah?
Let me read these people's statements to you. And inshallah ta'ala, let a lot of people understand this issue between us and them. It's not just an ayah that's been misunderstood wrong or an interpretation that happened to be misunderstood. Or it's not. Sanusi, who died 885, it's their imam. In Jama'at al-Asar, his kitabs are taught like his reference for these people. Any Ash'ari who's watching today will not dispute the imam and the jalal of these people. In Sharh al-Kubra, he mentioned. It's taught in our country as well. It's been Aqa'id Sab'a, they call it. He says, Usul al-Kufri Sitta. The foundation of Kufri is seven.
Okay. Sitta.
Yeah, six. He says the foundation. What did I say?
You said seven.
He says, Usul al-Kufri Sitta. The foundation of this belief is six. He mentioned five. And then look what he said after that. He said, sadisan, the sixth one is what? وَالتَّمْ أَتَّمَسُّكِ فِي أُصُولِ الْعَقَائِدِ بِمُجَرَّدِ ظَوَاهِرِ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. By holding on to the kitab and the sunnah of initials aqidah. مِنْ غَيْرِ بَصِيرَةٍ, without having any insight and knowledge of aql. هُوَ أَصْلُ ضَلَالِ الْحَشَوِيَّةِ فَقَالُ بِالتَّشْبِيهِ. And he said, this is the foundation of the Hashawiyah. Hashawiyah is, by the way, Ahlus-sunnah. They refer to Ahlus-sunnah as Hashawiyah. And they said, this is the reason why they fell into tashbih.
Okay.
Shahid.
Yeah.
He's saying, we fell into tashbih by holding on to the apparent verses of the Qur'an. Shahid, this is the issue I want. So in other words, the Qur'an is a form of disbelief. By holding on to the
if
Qur'an.
If you take it in a certain way, which we'd all say, right? If you take the Qur'an in a certain way, you can...
Shahid, would you say to someone, holding on to the apparent wording of the Qur'an is disbelieved? So what I'm trying to say to
there
you...
There are certain ayats like that though, right?
What? Ayats like what?
Certain hadith, like Bukhari, for example, about a man who is so righteous that his eyes become like the eyes of Allah and his... ears become like the ears of Allah that he hears with. If you took that upon the zahir, of course it's going to be kufr.
What do you mean? Like holding on to what? Holding on to
the zahir meaning, the apparent meaning of literally my eyes are going to be the eyes of Allah that I'm seeing.
The hadith doesn't say that. But
what does hadith say? You can understand where they're coming from.
No,
they're not talking about the whole Quran like you're making out. They're talking about certain ayat cannot be interpreted this way.
Shahid, let's look at it slowly. I think this point can't even be, no one can argue for this. And I'd like to hear the Asha'ira respond to this point, to be honest. Usul al-Kufri, to say holding on to Zawahiri. What he's saying is holding on to the apparent meaning of the Quran and the Sunnah. And he's saying, وَالتَّمَسُّكِ فِي أُصُولِ الْعَقَائِدِ. Not in issues of Aqeedah, to hold on to the Quran and the Sunnah. And he didn't say, if you don't go to the understanding of the Salaf. And maybe he got a point here. Even to say Kufr is too strong. He could have said Bid'ah. But he said, مِنْ غَيْرِ بَصِيرَةٍ فِي الْعَقْلِ, without having studied basically ilmul kalam and logic, he's saying this is why these guys are falling into what they fell into. Is that all he says? Shahid, in our books of Aqeedah, when Ibn Abdul Wahhab, other scholars, they saw, they mention what? اِعْلَمْ أَرْشَدَكَ اللَّهُ لِطَاعَةِ أَنَّ الْحَنِيفِيَةَ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ and then it was دَلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى. Things like that, right? Sunusi has a matan called Umul Barahin. And it's also referred to as Sunusiyat al-Sughra. He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Started the book. He said, Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. I'lam, know, anna al-hukm al-aqli yanhasiru fi thalathati aqsamin al-wujubi wal-istihalati wal-jawazi. He says, I'lam, know, anna al-hukm al-aqli. He was studying Aqeedah book, by the way. This is Aqeedah book taught in Azhar. Ashaa'ira study this book. It's one of the mutuns that they study. He started by saying, I'lam, know, anna al-hukm al-aqli. First line. The hukm aqli yanhasiru is restricted to three things. Al-wujub, something that must exist. Wal-istihala, something that's impossible for it to exist. And something that cannot possibly exist. Bayjuri explains on that. Ibrahim al-Bayjuri has a sharh on it. Look what he says. He said, إِنَّمَا اخْتَصَرَ الْمُسَنِّفُ. The author here, Yani Sunusi, restricted himself, عَلَى الْحُكْمِ الْعَقْلِ. He restricted himself in this book of Aqeedah. He restricted himself to the حُكْمُ الْعَقْلِ. دُونَ أَخَوَيْ. And he had left the other two brothers of his. What are the two other brothers? وَهُمَ الْحُكْمُ الْعَادِي وَالشَّرْعِ. He didn't mention حُكْمُ الْعَادِي and he didn't also mention حُكْمُ الشَّرْعِ. He only restricted himself to the حُكْمُ الْعَقْلِ in this book. لِأَنَّهُ why الْمُحْتَاجُ إِلَيْهِ فِي هَذَا الْفَنِّ دُونَهُمَا. That's what's needed in this science of Aqeedah. حُكْمُ الشَّرْعِ is not needed and حُكْمُ الْعَادِي is not needed in the science of Aqeedah. Shahid, these people don't believe the Qur'an and the Sunnah is an evidence. They don't believe that. And we're talking about not issues of fiqh, we're talking about issues of fundamental beliefs. There's a kitab called...
Are they talking about the fitrah here? That's not like...
No, he didn't say fitrah.
No, but that is, the aql is like part of the fitrah that Allah gives us, right? He gives us the aql as well.
The fitrah gives us, again, it's a good point that you brought that up. The fitrah proves the general points of aqidah.
Okay.
But like in detailed issues of aqidah, if fitrah is enough, why would Allah send prophets and messengers to explain to us Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
For fiqh and how to worship Him.
So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling us Allah's names and attributes, we could have known all of that through the fitrah.
It's how you make dua to Him as part of worship. That's part of worship.
Again, the fitrah can bring you to the truth.
Yeah.
The fitrah proves Allah's existence. But to know Allah tabarak wa ta'ala bit tafseel, Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا نَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ نَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Allah says to Muhammad, greatest man to have a walk on this earth, Allah Tabarak says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ. You didn't know these issues, Muhammad. يعني الإيمان here that's been referred to, the scholars, they said, it is تفاصيل الإيمان, detailed issues of إيمان, you didn't know that. So, why would Allah say in the Quran, رسول المبشرين ومذيرين لألا يكون للناس على الله حجة بعد الرسول. The reason why Allah sent messengers as warners and to give glad tidings is so the people don't have a proof the day of judgment against Allah. And Allah is teaching us Himself through the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So for them, like Allah,
okay.
Allah is known through the Aql. There's a kitab called Al-Qaridah Al-Bahiyya. It's written by Abu Barakat Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmed Ad-Dardir. He wrote it. He said, look what he says. It's an Aqeedah book. It's an Aqeedah book they study. Look what he says. He says, أقسام حكم العقل لا محالة هي الوجوب ثم الاستحالة ثم الجواز ثالث الأقسام ففهم نحت لذة الأفهام. He says, it's an Aqeedah book. It's the beginning. He finished the Bismillah and the Hamdallah. And then he says, أقسام حكم العقل لا محالة. Just exactly what Sanusi mentioned. Then I went to the sharah of Ahmed al-Sawi. Ahmed al-Sawi, he has a hashiya on Jalalain. Jalalain by Jalaluddin al-Mahalli and Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. When he comes to Surah Al-Kahf, that's a side benefit I just want to mention.
Okay.
Ahmed al-Sawi, when he comes to Surah Al-Kahf, he says from the usul al-kufr is also to hold on to the zahir al-nusus. I didn't bring that point for this point, but look at that. Anyways, he commented on the statement of Ahmed al-Dirdir. He says, Ahmed Sawi, he says, إِنَّمَا اخْتَصَرَ الْمُصَنِّفُ. The reason why the Musannif here mentioned the أحكام العقل كغيره من المتكلمين, like the other متكلمين have also done, is لأن مباحث هذا الفن, because this subject of عقيده لا تخرج عنه, it doesn't leave عقل, that's all it's restricted to.
Okay.
Again, let me just, there's, I think people really need to understand who we're dealing with. Bayjuri has a risala called Ilm al-Tawheed. By the way, these are books that we study.
There is just one contention. Sorry, I'm sorry to interrupt. There is one contention I want to bring in at this point. A lot of people say that Ibrahim alayhi salam also used the aql to prove the existence of God or the existence of Allah in the Quran.
Again, the ayah needs tafsir from us. It needs explanation from us. And to be honest, the ayah has no relationship with these people are saying. Bayjuri has a risala called Ilm al-Tawheed. He says, فَيَجِبُ فِي حَقِّهِ تَعَالَى. So this is an Aqeedah book. It's Ilm al-Tawheed is called. You're going to study Tawheed. You're an Ash'ari. This is the book you were taught. You learn it. Ibrahim al-Bayjuri is considered Shaykh al-Islam for them. They call him Shaykh al-Islam Ibrahim al-Bayjuri. Look what he says. It is Aqeedah Tawheed book.
Okay.
He says, فَيَجِبُ فِي حَقِّهِ تَعَالَى الْوُجُودُ. By the way, I read the Risala. I think there was only two verses he brought, two evidences he brought, the whole Risala. By the way, two evidences. I don't want people to quote me on it, but I read this a long time ago. Was it two evidences or maximum three evidences he brought?
In how many, like how long, how big are we talking? How many pages is
we're
it?
We're talking about like ثلاثة الأصول, something like okay. Small as that. Look at how he talks. Just want people to understand what Aqeedah for them is, and Ibn Abdul Wahhab's Risala, for example, or Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah, if you have read his Wasatiyah, we studied it. Wasatiyah, with Dalil Qawlu Ta'ala. So you, three, four pages, it's just Dalil. Ibn Abdul Wahhab, every time, with Dalil Qawlu Ta'ala, with Dalil, sah? That's very common in it. Yeah. Look what he does. He says, فَيَجِبُ فِي حَقِّهِ تَعَالَى الْوُجُودِ. For Allah, Tabarak wa Ta'ala, existence is a must. وَضِدُّهُ الْعَدَمَ. The opposite to existence is not to exist. وَالدَّلِيلُ. You're waiting for ayah in the Quran, right?
Yeah.
He says, وَالدَّلِيلُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ وُجُودُ الْمَخْلُوقَاتِ. The evidence for that is the existence of the creation. Shahid. Wallahi a'udhu billah. It's something to be shocked with. People studies as a form of tawheed. He says, وَيَجِبُ فِي حَقِّهِ تَعَالَى الْقِدَمُ. In Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He's always existed. وَمَعْنَاهُ. That means, أَنَّهُ لَا أَوَّلَ لَهُ. That there's no one before Him. He's the first. وَضِدُّهُ الْحُدُوثُ. The opposite to al-qidam is what? Hudooth, something that comes about. وَالدَّلِيلُ. You're waiting for an ayah and a hadith, right? He says, وَالدَّلِيلُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ أَنَّهُ لَوْ كَانَ حَادِثًا لَحْتَاجَ إِلَى مُحْدِثٍ وَهُوَ مُحَالٌ وَيَجِبُ فِي حَقِّهِ تَعَالَى الْبَقَاءُ وَمَعْنَهُ أَنَّهُ تَعَالَى لَا آخِرَ لَهُ والدليل the way to from the Quran is والدليل على ذلك أنه لو كان ثانيا لكان حادث حادثا وهو محال ويجب في حقه في حقه تعالى المخالفة للحوادث ومعناه أنه تعالى ليس مماثلا للحوادث فليس له يد ولا عين ولا أذن ولا غير ذلك من الصفات الحوادث ضدها المماثلة والدليل the way from على ذلك والدليل على ذلك أنه لو كان مماثلا للحوادث لكان حادثا وهو محال. He negates Allah's names and attributes with not one ayah or hadith. So ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير is just to يعني عامة الناس, the general mass, to calm them down and say relax, it's fine, we do use ayat in Quran. Wallahi, those people who are sympathizers of the ashaa'ira and are also the sympathizers of the mutakallimin, you just take one point from me. Look at their lectures and their reminders and their works. The Qur'an and the Sunnah are very little because they don't see it as a proof. You hear a guy who says, I'm studied, I know Aqeedah, that's my field of expertise. He does a whole entire podcast. وَلَا يَسْتَدِلُّ بِآيَةٍ. He won't use one ayah. He won't use a hadith. He would give a whole entire lecture. The why are you like this? The reason is because the evidence. Shahid, I want to say something and I really want people to take this in on board because this is a very dangerous path, which is, what are we dealing with today? We're dealing with very serious ideologies out there. If a people just dismiss the Quran like that, who have they opened the door for? If you say aql to the people, you are now letting ISIS exist. You're breeding an ideology of ISIS. Of course you are. You're telling everybody aql. Your mind.
ISIS called the Quran hadith.
We have nothing against ISIS. If we say everybody use your aql, they can be like, whoa, I'm using my aql.
Oh,
that's why I bombed these people. My aql told me that these people are not innocent. I should kill them. You know what I mean? You open the door to kulla man habba wa dab. So fighting with these people is very important. It's not a light issue. I also now want to go into another issue to show you these people are very dangerous even in their concept of iman.
Before, I don't think that contention was answered properly. You just said it requires tafsir. But you know, I've heard multiple people use this. Ibrahim alayhi salam did use the aql to prove Allah's existence. He's a prophet from the greatest five prophets. And you're saying now that this is a wrong methodology.
Ibrahim alayhi salam said that Allah's words are not evidences. Did Ibrahim alayhi salam say Allah's words should not be taken into consideration? Did Ibrahim alayhi salam say if the aql and the words of Allah, they come together, we give precedence to our logic over the statements of Allah? We should know that what evidence we use, it shouldn't be like the man who said Mawlid is permissible and he was asked, what's your evidences? أَفَلَمْ يَنْظُرُونَ أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Anyone can mock the religion like that. You got a dalil? Okay, what are you using it for? Can't just pull a verse out of somewhere. By the way, we're not saying aql cannot be used for aqidah.
Okay.
We're not saying that. Again, I did say it before. I said that sound mind will not contradict the authentic evidences. And the scholars of Ahlus-sunnah do prove that. Shaykh al-Islam, when he refuted dar'u ta'arud al-aqli wal-naql, he debunked him on these issues from a rational perspective as well, and showed him that the Quran and the Sunnah don't contradict each other. The Quran and the Sunnah don't contradict the aql, rather they complement one another. Ibn Taymiyyah did use logic, and we do use that to them. We prove it to them logically that the Quran and the Sunnah go in line with the sound mind. That being said, if there comes an issue I can't understand, I need to know my mind, my aql is restricted. It's qasir. And the one that's superior is the Quran and the Sunnah. I gave you an example before. I said to you, the eyes of the person is restricted. You can't see everything. The distance of how far you can see is very restricted. If I switch off this light in this room right now, you won't be able to see me. But your eyes are still functioning. The aql also needs evidence like that to support. Like the light for the aql is the revelation.
But how do you interpret the revelation without the aql?
I just said that to you before. The Quran and the Sunnah, there are issues which are fundamental usul, which the Islam and the Muslims have all agreed upon. There are issues in the religion that are fundamental. We've agreed on these issues. قَرْنًا بَعْدَ قَرْنٍ. Let me just give you some.
I'm sorry to stick on it, but this thing that you just brought the example, my eyesight, you said, is like the aql, it's limited.
Yeah.
And the lights are the nusus al-wahyain, the Quran and the Sunnah. Yeah. If my aql is limited and I can't see past certain distance, it doesn't matter what lights are on, I'm still not going to be able to see it. Like, my aql is limited. So I get to I get to an ayah, I don't understand it and I will never understand it. I cannot understand it because my aql is limited.
First of all, you have to understand what you don't understand doesn't mean everybody else doesn't understand it. It might be something to you. It might be a problem with you. Surrender to the Nusus al-Wahyain. What I'm trying to say, Shahid, here right now, and I'm trying to drive this point home. These people, the aql takes precedence over every single thing. Let me give you, to show you these issues are agreed upon and you just have to surrender. They still say, no, it doesn't rationally make sense to me. Give you an example. Mas'alatul iman, I have to show this as an example. It was narrated from Imam al-Bukhari authentically that Bukhari said, لَقِيتُ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ أَلْفِ رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ. I met more than 1,000 people. More than a thousand. Who's this? Imam al-Bukhari. I met him. He said, لَقِيتُ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ أَلْفِ رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ بِالْأَمْصَارِ. I met them in all different places. Not one restricted area. Amsar. Look what he said. فَمَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا مِنْهُمْ. I did not see one of them. يَخْتَلِفُ differing. في أن الإيمان قول وعمل, that the iman is speech and action. ويزيد وينقص, that the iman increases and it decreases. This consensus has also been transmitted. Lalakai transmitted it from who? He transmitted it from who? الإمام الشافعي, الإمام أحمد بن حنبل, إمام إسحاق بن راهوية, أبو عبيد. The Quran proves, so then is إجماع. There's no difference of opinion on this issue. There's an إجماع. Allah mentions it in the Quran. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. That the believers are the ones when the Quran is recited, their hearts tremble. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. When the Quran is recited on them, it increases their iman. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. They rely on who? Their Lord. Allah then says, الَّذِينَ, the ones, the believers, يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ, they establish a prayer. And then the salah has been mentioned with iman, which is an action. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, and they give from the money and the wealth Allah gave them. Allah then says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا, these are the true believers. لَهُمْ دَرَجَاتٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ وَأَشَاعِرُ. What do they believe about iman? Ashaa'ira. What do they believe about iman? What's their view regarding iman? Al-Imam Al-Baqilani, in his kitab Al-Insaf, he says, أَنَّ الْإِيمَانَ بِاللَّهِ, believing in Allah تبارك وتعالى, هُوَ التَّصْدِيقُ بِالْقَلْبِ. It's just to believe in your heart. Shahid.
No actions.
You don't even have to say, رَشَدُوا لَا إِلَهَ لَا وَشَدُوا مُحَمْدَ رَسُولَهَ تَأَنْتَ إِسْلَامَ, according to the Ash'a'irah. All you have to just do is believe in your heart. Juwayni says the same in his Irshad إلى قواطع الأدلة في أصول الاعتقاد. He says, وَالْمَرْضِيُّ عِنْدَنَا. What is pleasing to us is أن حقيقة الإيمان التصديق بالله تعالى. فالمؤمن بالله من صدقه. The iman to us is what? It's the one who believes in Allah. The mu'min is the one who affirms Allah in his heart. بس خلاص هذا هو. أبو الحسن الأشعري in his كتاب اللمع, what did he say? He said الإيمان التصديق بالله. شاهد, I just brought you what? الإمام البخاري was saying لقيت أكثر من ألف رجل من العلماء بالأمصار. It's a mas'ala ijma'. The Quran, I just mentioned to you, Allah mentions salah. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentions zakat, which is an action, sadaqah, giving your wealth. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned the recitation of the Quran, all of that, which are actions. They say, al-iman, it's not because, akhi, the Quran is, they believe something. Their heads have got something convinced. The Quran does, if you bring it to an Ash'ari, say, qala Allah ta'ala, he'll say to you, how do you know Abu al-Hasan never saw this verse? How it's all of that is a smoke screen. The Prophet said in a hadith, al-iman bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba. Iman is 70 and odd AMAU, bid'un wa sittuna, or 60 odd branches. The hadith says, a'laha qawlu la ilaha illallah. The highest level is what? La ilaha illallah. Wa adnaha, and the lowest of it is what? Imatatul adha anil tariq, to remove harm from the path. والحياء شعبة من الإيمان. And shyness is part of الإيمان. Bukhari and Muslim both narrate that in their Sahih on the authority of Abu Huraira. The Prophet here is saying iman is actions. La ilaha illallah is iman. To them, it's not.
Yeah, okay. So what you're saying in summary is that we defined the Ahlus-sunnah, the people of the sunnah, as being people who take the Qur'an, the sunnah, and understand the companions. And we all affirm that, and you brought many evidences to prove that's the point. And that's something that the Asha'ara on the apparent won't disagree with either, that definition of Ahlus.
So let me just mention one more quote on this particular point. There's a man who they look up to. His name is called Burhanuddin Ibrahim ibn Harun al-Laqani. Ibrahim al-Laqani is known as. He's got a matan in Tawheed. It's called Jawharatu Tawheed. That kitab is taught in our country. It's from the Aqaid al-Sab'a, they call it. And it's one of those books you have to study as an Ash'ari. I mean, this is where they tadarruj. You know how you have Mustawa al-Awwalin? This is Mustawa al-Awwal, Mustawa al-Thani, Thalith, Akada. Jawharatu Tawheed has an explanation on it, which is the one I keep referencing from Bayjuri's Tuhfatul Murid. Now I'm going to mention what Ibrahim al-Laqani said, and then I'm going to the explanation, I'm not going to take it from anybody else except them, Bayjuri's explanation.
Okay, fine.
He said, وَفُسِّرَ الْإِيمَانُ بِالتَّصْدِيقِ وَالنُّطْقُ فِيهِ الْخُلْفُ بِالتَّحْقِيقِ. Iman has been explained, yani, according to us, ashaa'irah, بِالتَّصْدِيقِ, just to believe in Allah. وَالنُّطْقُ فِيهِ الْخُلْفُ بِالتَّحْقِيقِ. And there is a dispute in whether the utterance of that word matters. And they're disputing whether a person wants to come into Islam, would he be a Muslim or not? If he doesn't say it. There's a dispute amongst themselves. And the jumhur of them believe what? It's not. Look what Bayjuri said in Tuhfatul Murid when he explained the word. He said, فَمَنْ صَدَّقَ بِقَلْبِهِ. Anyone who believes in his heart, وَلَمْ يُقِرَّ بِلِسَانِهِ, but does not state it on his tongue, لَا لِعُذْرٍ مَنَعَهُ. Shahid, there's no reason that's preventing him from it. And it's not like he can't speak, he's mute, he's none of that. مَنَعَهُ وَلَا لِإِبَاءٍ. But, and it's not out of, also out of arrogance why he doesn't want to say it. But اتفق له ذلك. It just happened to be the case. فهو مؤمن عند الله. He's a believer according to Allah. غير مؤمن في الأحكام الدنيوية. But in this world, we won't consider him a believer. When you look at him, we're not going to say believer. But really, in reality, he's a believer. When the messenger sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal and he said, إنك ستأتي قوم أهل الكتاب فليكن أول ما تدعوهم إليه شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله. Let the first thing that you call them to be لا إله إلا الله. Also, the Prophet ﷺ saying, "Qulu, la ilaha illallah tuflihu." Say, "La ilaha illallah," you'll find success. When he came to his uncle Abu Talib, and Abu Talib was on his deathbed, do you not think Abu Talib believed in the Prophet's prophecy? He said, "Well, qad alimtu bi anna deena Muhammad khayrul bariyyati deena. Lawla al-malamatu al-hidara musabbatina wajatani bi dhaka samham mubina." He's establishing the Prophet's prophecy.
Yeah, but it's not the same as iman, is it? Like in the heart. Isn't that iman is the heart?
He believed in the Prophet.
Iman is wider than that.
He believed in his heart the Prophet's prophecy. He believed in the message of Nabi Muhammad. He said, if it wasn't for the blame of my forefathers, if it wasn't, وَلِذَٰلِكَ, that's why they believe Abu Talib is a believer. That's another discussion. Abu Talib is a Muslim to them.
Okay, you don't, like, I always try and be just and fair and think, where are they getting this from? You don't think the ayat that say Allah is alimu bidhati sudur, for example, that Allah knows what's in your chest. Isn't that enough to show that this person's a Muslim, that he believes he has iman in his chest and he just doesn't utter it? Maybe they're interpreting these ayat and taking it as part of their belief. I'm just saying that you're looking at the Nusus al-Wahya in one way, they're looking at it another way. Can't we just be fair and say that you're both trying ijtihaad?
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi. I just mentioned the Quran referred to. Ya'ani, to them, salah is not it. It's not part of iman. And I only really want you to understand it. Iman is only at-tasdiq. This is not just only the belief of the misguided group. It's ghulatul murji'a. These guys are the extremist form of the murji'a. The extremist, that's the ashaa'ira's belief. Shahid, if there would be any way to yani, look at these people and say, you know what, there is a chance for them to be, yani, I would say it. I wouldn't. I know people are going to watch this. I know thousands of people are going to watch this.
And you've been quoting.
And I know every single statement I've said, it will be looked at. It will be... Yeah. I know when they watch this, they're going to try to look through it. But anyone who's munsif, who's just, who knows that Yawm al-Qiyamah is going to stand in front of Allah, Yawm al-Qiyamah, and is going to be questioned and interrogated. And if he lies, Allah Ta'ala will make his body part speak. He would question all of this. He'll question all of this.
And you've been quoted from their scholars, not your scholars.
That's one thing I made sure. Everything I brought you, what Abu Bakr al-Baqillani mentioned, Fakhruddin al-Razi said, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni, Ibrahim al-Bayjuri, Ibrahim al-Laqani, what they, Sunusi, what they said. I'm not going to say Ibn Taymiyyah said about them this. Nah.
Okay.
They've testified to this.
Okay.
Do you know, which increases the issue in problems, do you believe, or do you know that the Asha'ira believe that the Qur'an is created?
That's definitely not what they say.
Asha'ira believe the Qur'an that we have today is makhluq. Everything Ahmed ibn Hanbal was fighting against when it came to the Mu'tazila, and the reason why he was imprisoned, and the whole entire reason why Nu'aym ibn Hamad al-Khuza'i was killed, and Buwayti, the student of Imam al-Shafi'i, was killed, and Ahmed was lashed and beaten, and the whole reason Ibn Abi Duad and Bishr al-Marisi and all these guys, the whole entire khilaf that you saw that happen, Asha'ira today adopted the ideology that the Quran is makhluq. What do I mean? Allah told us that the Quran is the speech of Allah.
Mm-hmm.
Allah says in the Quran, وَرُسُلًا قَدْ قَصَصْنَاهُمْ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَرُسُلًا لَمْ نَقْصُصْهُمْ عَلَيْكَ وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah tells that He spoke to Nabi Musa. We know Allah has a characteristics which He firms for Himself. Kalam. Asha'ira, one of the things they do, and they're very good at this, is they deceive the Amma. They deceive the people. Hence why their ideology spread. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention that as we speak further, inshallah, if I get the chance to. They're very deceptive. They have something for the general mass and the people, and they have something in their private circles.
For the people who have knowledge.
Yeah.
What's the issue? So what's the issue with that of teaching people at their level? You teach an advanced class, what's the problem?
You're not saying to someone that I'm going to teach you about the doubts of other groups. That could be for advanced students of knowledge who can handle it, who've got the knowledge for it. We're talking about our ideology. We've tell something to the Ammatunnah so they just know and they calm down. And when it comes to circles of knowledge, we really tell them what we really believe.
How do you know their intentions?
I'll come to it. I'm quoting.
What if it's just an issue of advance and beginner?
Everything I will mention what they said. Asha'ira, they say to the people, there are seven characteristics we affirm. From those seven characteristics is kalam. When you see that, you think, Allahumma barik. They actually affirm Allah's speech. What they affirm is that the kalam that they affirm is the kalam which is qa'imun bidatillah, the speech that's present in Allah. I don't know what that means. You wouldn't understand what that means. Mm. No Arab, no scholar in the Arabic language, no sane person ever said speech is what's inside you that doesn't come out. But to them, somehow it does. Why?
The ability to speak.
No, not the ability. I've got, give me a second. I just thought about something. To them, that's speech. That was a speech, just kalam. They're saying, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah has a great example and there's nothing I can compare Him to, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm not comparing to myself. But they're saying that the speech is present in Allah. Okay? That is what they affirm as the speech of Allah. The Qur'an that we have today, that is we're reading, we're making our children memorize, who we read in weddings, if we want to make a person make an oath, we make him use this Qur'an, we swear by this Qur'an, they believe it's makhluq.
Yeah, are they talking about the papers, the mushaf?
Shahid, the Qur'an that we're reading, this whole entire Qur'an is makhluq to the Asha'ira. Let me, first of all, so that Ahmadun Nas know what the Qur'an is, before I bring the shubha to them. Let me mention the verses to prove that the Quran is the speech of Allah.
And makhluq means for the.
And I'll explain what makhluq means. Yeah. First of all, Allah tells us in the Quran, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah spoke to Nabi Allah Musa. Also, Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala, He says, وَلَمَّا جَاءَ مُوسَى لِمِقَاتِنَا وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ. Allah spoke to him. قَالَ رَبِّ أَرِنِي أَنظُرُ إِلَيْكَ قَالَ لَن تَرَانِي وَلَكِن انظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ فَإِن اسْتَقَرَّ مَكَانَهُ فَسَوْفَ تَرَانِي. Allah mentions, وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ. Allah spoke to Nabi Allah Musa. By the way, to be fair, a lot of the Asha'ira believe what happened between Nabiullah Musa and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A large number of them believe that was speech. They believe that. So a large number of them affirm that. See, we mention what they say and what they, we won't take it away from them. Also, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, وَإِنَ أَحَدُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرُوا حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغُهُ مَأْمَنَا ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Look what Allah says. He says, وَإِنْ أَحَدُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. If one of the disbelievers come to you and say to you, give me shelter. Allah said, فَأَجِرُ. Give him shelter. Protection. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. Until he hears the speech of Allah. Then the speech of Allah is something that is heard. ثم أبلغوا مأمنا, and then make him reach a safe place. ذلك بأنهم قوم لا يعلمون. The reason to this is because they are people who don't know. Also Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says سيقول لك المخلفون, سيقول المخلفون إذا انطلقتم إلى مغانم لتأخذوها ذرونا نتبعكم يريدون أن يبدلوا كلام الله. By the way, this came in Surah Al-Fatih. It's talking about the conquest of Mecca. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he's saying about them, يُرِيدُونَ, they want, أَنْ يُبَدِّلُوا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ, they want to change the speech of Allah. Then this Qur'an, which is the kalam of Allah, is what they're trying to change. Ashaa'ira don't consider this to be the kalam of Allah, which is they believe this one is makhluq. Kalamullah is the one which is قَائِمُ بِذَاتِهِ. I'm going to come to this inshallah. Also Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he says, فَلَمَّا أَتَاهَا نُودِيَ مِنْ شَاطِئِ الْوَادِ الْأَيْمَنِ فِي الْبُقْعَةِ الْمُبَارَكَةِ مِنَ الشَّجَرَةِ أَيَّا مُوسَى إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah yelled to Musa, according to no language does a nida become something that's not coming out of you. Nida means to call someone out. So Allah also says, قَالَ رَبِّ جَعَلْ لِي آيَةً. This is one of the strongest evidence in the Quran to prove that Allah تبارك وتعالى speaks with two things. حَرْفٌ وَصَوْتٌ. Sound and words. Allah, sound, yes, and words. Nabiullah Zakariya, when he wanted to have a child, or Allah تبارك وتعالى, sorry, when Allah تبارك وتعالى told him he's going to have a child, he said to Allah, قَالَ رَبِّ جَعَلْ لِي آيَةً. I want a sign that my wife is pregnant, and I want to know that she's pregnant, and she is... I want to know that she's pregnant and the child and the process has started. So he said, قَالَ رَبِّ جَعَلْ لِي آيَةً. Oh Allah, make me a sign. Allah said to him, قَالَ آيَتُكَ أَلَّا تُكَلِّمَ النَّاسَ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامٍ إِلَّا رَمْزًا. The sign that you're going to be given is that you will not be able to speak to the people إِلَّا رَمْزًا إِلَّا with إشارة. And then Allah says, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ كَثِيرًا وَسَبِّحْ بِالْعَشِيِّ وَالْإِبْكَارِ. Shahid ponder here. Allah says, قَالَ آيَتُكَ أَلَّا تُكَلِّمَ النَّاسَ. The sign, the alama that's given to you, Zakariya, is that you will not be able to speak. If speech is something that's within you, Zakariya was speaking inside because he was doing ishara. He was telling them, illa ramzan means ay isharatan. He was telling them, do this, be quiet. He was talking to them like this. According to the Asha'ira, that's kalam. So what's the benefit? Qala ayatu, alla tukallim an-nas, you not speak to the people. The speech that's being negated here is harfun wa sawt. Zakariya will not be able to utter anything. ولذلك ابن كثير, he said, إشارة لا تستطيع النطق. Allah will give you ramzan means what? Allah will give you إشارة. You can point things, but you're not going to be able to pronounce anything. مع أنك سوي صحيح. Even though you are healthy, there's no illness with you, you're mute, you can't talk. What is the kalam Allah is negating here? The kalam Allah is negating here is what? To vocalize it, to utter things.
You understand why they call you the mushabbiha, right? Of statements like this.
When I say we affirm Allah's characteristics, by the way, we're not saying we affirm Allah's characteristics in the way the creation have it.
You just said with sound and words. No, but the same way you speak with sound and words, you're just saying Allah speaks with sound and words.
No, but I'm saying Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, I speak. Huh? And speak is only in Arabic language, because Allah's talking to us in Arabic language. وإنه لتنزيل رب العالمين نزل به الروح الأمين على قلبك لتكون من المذنين بلسان عربي مبين. The Quran is in the Arabic language. Arabs know the word kalam to mean حرف وصوت. That's all they know it as. Number one. You have to know that's important.
Arabs are humans, right?
No. Allah tells, he said the Quran in the language of these people. Fine. It makes no sense that the Arabs unanimously understand kalam to mean حرف وصوت. And Allah means something else. When Allah is saying the Quran, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَكُمْ وَيَهْدِيَكُمْ سَنُوَ لَلَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Allah wants to clarify things to you. Allah wants to guide you. How can you say but Allah
is talking to you? It just can't be, their argument would be, it can't be with words and sounds, because that's how we speak. And Allah is not like us in any way, shape or form. Whatever you think of Allah, it's something else.
First of all, I just mentioned to you, when Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِنَ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرُهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. فلما جاء موسى لميقاتنا وكلمه ربه. شاهد, we're talking about verses where Allah says kalam. These people only understand بإجماع. I'm going to bring in إجماع later inshallah ta'ala, that the word kalam only means this. But to make it even more clearer, if they still are stubborn, and again I'm telling you Shahid, they are not rejecting all of this because the evidence is not clear, or they're using another hadith, they don't believe the Quran and the Sunnah is evidence.
Kalam nafsi actually affirms both. You actually reconciles between Shahid, and kalam of Allah that he's affirming.
No,
you've done it both.
No, where they're going to take this hadith of Bukhari. Min hadithi Abi Sa'id al-Khudri. Yaqulu Allah, Allah will say, Ya Adam, Adam. Fayaqulu labbayk wa sa'adik. He'll say, oh Allah, I'm here to obey you and listen to you. Allah will say, Fayunadi, the hadith is saying, Fayunadi, Allah will call out. Bi sawtin. Allah will call out. Bi sawtin. Fayunadi. Bi sawtin. Two things they can't take out of this place. Yaqulu Allah is the beginning of the hadith. Allah will say, Fayunadi bi sawtin. Abu Qasim al-Taymiyyah, he says, Nida to the Arabs is not, Nida has no other meaning except with sound. Also, the Quran is harf. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us it's words. We know the Quran is harf, right? Man qara'a harfan min kitabila falahu bihi hasana. Now, kalam is by unanimous agreement, according to the people of the Arabic language and according to the ulama of Islam. Abu Nasr al-Sijzi, who died in 444, Abu Nasr al-Sijzi, Dhahabi said about him, Al-Imam, Al-Alim, Al-Hafidh, Al-Mujawwid, Shaykh al-Sunnah. I need him for later, inshallah ta'ala. When I mentioned 16 or 15, I had actually more than that, if time allows me later, who stated Ashaa'ira are not min Ahlus-sunnah, they are min Ahlul Dalal. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll mention them later. Abu Nasr al-Sijzi, who died in 444 Hijriya, he said, Al-Kalam la yakunu illa harfan wa sawtan. Speech cannot be except with sound or words. تأليف واتساق. وقالت العرب, the Arabs they say, الكلام اسم وفعل وحرف جاء لمعنى. It's what you took in the Jurumiyah. كلامنا لفظ مفيد وسكستقلم واسم وفعل ثم حرف الكلم واحده كلمة والقول عام وكلمة بها كلام قد يؤم بالجر والتنوين والندى وال. We study that in grammar. Al-Fitr Malik mentions that. Al-Jurumiyah mentions that. يعني اسم وفعل وحرف جاء لمعنى. That's what كلام is. كلام is اسم. Who said Qur'an is something inside you? Ism, I have to hear ism. Arf. Look what it says. فَالْإِسْمُ مِثْلُ زَيْدٍ وَحَامِدٍ وَالْفِعْلُ مِثْلُ جَاءَ وَذَهَبَ وَقَامَ وَقَعَدَ. Look what it then said. فَالْإِجْمَاعُ, the consensus, مُنْعَقِدٌ بَيْنَ الْعُقَلَ. He said, no, just the ulama of Islam. The unanimous agreement between the sane people is عَلَى كَوْنِ الْكَلَامِ حَرْفًا وَصَوْتًا. Every sane person will say to you, speech is what's heard. If I sat here all day and I looked at you, and I got up and you said to me, Akhi, why do you not want to talk to me? And I said, Akhi, I was talking to you all day.
But you'll say, Akhi. You're saying pointing is not speech.
No, it's not.
So when Allah says, Illa Ramza, He's put it with speech.
Illa?
Ramza, in the ayah that you cited, He's put it with speech. He said, you will not speak except with Ramza, with pointing.
No, right? Allah is saying you will not speak.
That's part of speech then.
No, it's not. It's not. Ramzan is ishara, is to point out towards things. Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala, you, Muhammad, you, Zakariya, will not be able to speak.
Except
Allah will allow you to give ishara.
That means that is a speech that you're allowed to. You're not allowed to speak. It's like if I say, for example,
it's like me saying you're not allowed to go, but you can eat.
No, that's different. Exception is taken from.
Not always.
So it's like, all right, everybody leave the room except.
No, not every time. Not every time.
You're in the room.
Ja al qawmu illa al himar, the Arabs, they say. That's famous. The Arabs, they say that. It doesn't have to be same jins. But the point is that the ijma' I just brought, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ in Sahih Bukhari, min hadith Abi Hurairah, where he said, فَيُنَادِي بِصَوْتٍ. Abu Qasim al-Taymi in his kitab al-Hujjah fi bayan al-Muhajjah, he says, وَقَدْ أَجْمَعَ أَهْلُ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ, the people of the Arabic language, all agree upon what? أَنَّ مَا عَدَ الْحُرُوفَ وَالْأَصْوَاتِ لَيْسَ بِكَلَامِ الْحَقِيقَةِ. That's not his speech. He doesn't have no sound or anything to it. The Arabs all agree upon the fact that it's what? It is not speech. Now I've mentioned that this is what these people, even Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini has a very powerful statement. It's long, but I think the students of knowledge and the brothers should go back to it. Now that I've mentioned what the ijma' of Ahlus-Sunnah, and I mentioned the Qur'an and what it said about, what do Asha'ira believe regarding the Qur'an? I just said to you that Asha'ira believe the Qur'an is created. Listen to this. First of all, Bayjuri says in his Hashiya, or his explanation on Jawhar al-Tawheed, he says, إِنَّهُ صِفَةٌ أَزَلِيَّةٌ قَائِمَةٌ بِذَاتِ اللَّهِ. The speech, is a characteristics that's azali, and it always been there, and it's present in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and always going to be there. He said, "Laysat bi sawtin wala harfin." It is not sound or harf. Shayla gave you hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari min hadith Abi Hurairah, where the Prophet said, "Fayunadi bi sawtin." Also, I just mentioned to you hadith, "Man qara'a harfan min kitabillahi." Harf and sawt were mentioned by the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Bayjuri goes against what Nabiullah Muhammad said. You think this is just, again, a mukhalaf of just one hadith? No, they're not evidences to him. Al-Qadi Abu Bakr al-Baqilani, look what he said, وَلَا يَجُوزُ بَاقِلَانِ. Again, the reason why I mentioned Bayjuri is because he's mutakhirin. And Abu Bakr al-Baqilani is from the mutakaddimin. Look what he said, وَلَا يَجُوزُ أَن يُطْلَقَ عَلَى كَلَامِ شَيْءٌ مِنْ أَمَرَاتِ الْحَدَّةِ مِنْ حَرْفٍ وَلَا صَوْتٍ. We cannot refer to the speech of Allah with harf and sawt. Ghazali says it the same as well in his kitab al-iqtisad, al-i'tiqad. He said, it's sifatun azaliyatun qadimatun qa'imatun bidatillahi ghayra munfasilatun anhu laysat biharfin wala sawt. Shahrastani in his Milal wa Nihal, he mentions from Abil Hasan al-Ash'ari that he said, wa kalamuhu wahidun huwa amrun wa nahyun wa khabarun wa istikhbarun wal ibarat wal alfadhul munazzalatu ala lisan al-mala'ikati ila al-anbiya'i alayhim salatu wa salam dalalatun ala al-kalam al-azali wa dalalatu makhluqatun muhdatha wal madlulu qadimun azali. Shahid, please listen to this. Here Shahrastani mentions that Abil Hasan al-Ash'ari said, inna lillahi wa inna ila raji'un. He said the speech of Allah is one. It's a command, prohibition. It is also khabar, news Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and that which Allah is telling us about. And then after that, what he said, he says, وَالْعِبَارَاتُ وَالْأَلْفَاظُ الْمُنَزَّلَةُ. These wordings that we have in the Mus'haf, which was brought to us, عَلَى لِسَانِ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, from the tongues of the angels, إِلَى الْأَنْبِيَاءِ, to the prophets, عَلَيْهِمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ, دَلَالَاتٌ عَلَى الْكَلَامِ الْأَزَلِي. They are an indication on the other kalam of Allah. Then there's another kalam. There's a kalam which is present in Allah, and there's also the kalam that we have, which is the ibarat and the alfaz that we have, that the angels come down with. He says, this one that we have, that the angels come down with, وَدَلَالَاتُ مَخْلُوقَةٌ مُحْدَتَةٌ. This one, he's saying, Shahrastani is taking the statement of Al-Hasan Ash'ari, that the speech of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he categorized it into two. He said there's a speech which is present in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that one is not created.
Okay.
When they say to you, we affirm Allah's characteristics. When they say to you, we affirm Allah's characteristics.
Mm.
Sorry, the characteristics of kalam,
yeah,
they're referring to, and it's not created. When they say that, they're referring to the one that's present within Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the one they call kalam, which is يعني قائمة بذات الله تبارك. That's present in Allah تبارك وتعالى. That was not makhluq, which we don't believe in exists. Aslan, it's not kalam. Kalam is what? بحرف وصوت. So the kalam we refer to is this one. This is what we talk about.
Okay.
The Quran, when it talks about kalam, of the Quran being the kalam of Allah, is talking about this. This one that we have is, he's saying, والدلالات مخلوقة محدثة. This one is created that we have. وَالْمَدْلُولُ قَدِيمُ الْأَزَلِي. The one with Allah, that's always been there and it's not an issue. Bayjuri, you said something very shocking in his Jawharatu Tawheed, when he explains, Tuhfatu al-Murid, the expression of Jawharatu Tawheed, he says, وَعْلَمْ نَوْ أَنَّ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ يُطْلَقُ عَلَى الْكَلَامِ النَّفْسِي الْقَدِيمِ بِمَعْنَى أَنَّهُ صِفَةٌ قَائِمَةٌ بِذَاتِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَعَلَى الْكَلَامِ اللَّفْظِي بِمَعْنَى أَنَّهُ خَلَقَهُ. انتهى كلامه. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَى رَاجِعُونَ. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَى رَاجِعُونَ. He says, no, that the speech of Allah is referred to two things. The first one is al-kalam al-nafsiyul qadim, the speech which is nafsi, that's present within Allah, the speech that is within Allah, that's one. That one, he said, bima'ana sifatun qa'imatun bidatillah, that's a characteristic that's present within Allah. That's one kalam. Also, kalam is referred to as what? Wa'ala al-kalam al-lafzi, which is the Quran that we have. Annahu bima'ana annahu khalaqahu. That means Allah created this one. Bayjuri is saying that. Also, he says, وَمَذْهَبُ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ بِمَعْنَى الْكَلَامِ النَّفْسِيِّ لَيْسَ بِمَخْلُوقٍ وَأَمَّا الْقُرْآنُ بِمَعْنَى اللَّفْظِ الَّذِي نَقْرَأُهُ فَهُوَ مَخْلُوقٌ. The Quran that we read right now is makhluq. The one that's within Allah is not created. Here he says something very shocking, which I kept mentioning. I'm going to point this out and I'm going to make sure everyone hears about this one, which is what? Ashaa'ira are very deceptive people. There is a madhab for the people and there's a madhab for the students of knowledge that they tell. He said, he already told us right now that there's two kalam. There's a kalam which is, they call it kalam nafsi, that's within Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Mm-hmm. And then this one which he called it, the kalam which is the one we have right now, the Quran that we have right now. And he said, this one's created, right? Then he said, لَكِنْ يَمْتَنِعُ أَنْ يُقَالَ لَكِنْ يَمْتَنِعُ أَنْ يُقَالَ. He said, what is prohibited is to say, Al-Qur'anu makhluq. To use to say like that, Quran is created. We withhold from that. وَيُرَادُ بِهِ اللَّفْظِ الَّذِي نَقْرَأُ. When you really intend the one that's been recited, you shouldn't just say it like that. إِلَّا فِي مَقَامِ التَّعْلِيمِ. Except when you're educating the students of knowledge. That's when you bring it out and you tell them that the word is makhluq. Why? لأنه ربما أوهم أن القرآن بما على كلامه تعالى مخلوق. The person might think that the one within Allah is مخلوق. So to avoid that confusion, don't say it. شاهد بوصيري, his Burda is one of the books that's read in the Mawlid. They love it. They read it in the Mawlid. بوصيري said something. He said, لو ناسبت قدره آيات عظما أحيى اسمه حين يدعى دارس الربم. He says, if Nabiullah, he said Allah tabarak wa ta'ala did not give Nabiullah Muhammad. Allah did not give Nabiullah Muhammad that which is worthy of his honor. The Quran Allah gave him as a mu'jiza is not worthy of the Prophet's honor. If Allah was really to give Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam something he's worthy of, it would have been that if his name is mentioned sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what would happen is حِينَ يُدْعَى دَارِسَ الرِّمَمِ, the bones and the people come alive. Everybody will come alive. If Allah was to really honor Nabiullah Muhammad as he deserves, the honor of the Prophet is so high, what Allah gave him is so low. If Allah really wanted to honor him, he would have made him be a means for people that when his name is mentioned, they all come to life. So you don't think I just translated the way I wanted to. Bayjuri does it. He explains it like that. When he explains the Burda, he says, the reason for that is because what you think to yourself, how can the Quran that we have is not enough for the prophets? And the poet, he said, جَاءَ النَّبِيُّونَ بِالْآيَاتِ فَانْصَرَمَتْ وَجِئْتَ لَا بِحَكِيمٍ غَيْرَ مُنْصَرِمٍ آيَاتُ كُلَّ مَا طَالَ الْمَدَى جُدَدُ يُبَيِّنُونَ جَمَالُ الْعِتْقِ وَالْقِدَمِ. Every prophet came with a miracle for his people to believe in him. Musa came with a stick. Isa came with his miracles. Every prophet came with a miracle for his people to believe in him. And Nabiullah Muhammad came with a miracle that didn't die when he passed away, alayhi salatu wasalam. The miracle still stands. It's still, in kuntum fi raybin mimma nazzalna ala 'abidina fa'tu bi surati min mithli wad'u shuhada'akum min dunillahi in kuntum sadiqin. It's a miracle that stands, right? So the poet is saying, you've come, Allah has sent onto you Muhammad with this everlasting miracle. Yani this is something Nabiullah Muhammad came with and it will never come to an end. But what's the reason why they believe what has been given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this Quran, is not worthy of him? What's the reason? The reason for this is because Nabiullah Muhammad is created and the Quran that we have is created. So if they're both created, the Prophet is the best of creation. Bayjuri says that. He says, لِأَنَّ الْوَاقِعَ أَنَّ قَدْرَهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَعْظَمُ مِنْ آيَاتِهِ. The Prophet is greater than the ayat of Allah. حَتَّى مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ الْمَتْلُوِ. Even the Quran that we recite. بِخِلَافِ الْقُرْآنِ غَيْرِ الْمَتْلُوِ. But not the Quran that's not recited. And then there's two Qurans. There's a Quran that's not recited and there's a Quran which is recited. Where did this come from? Where? That's what they believe. He said that the Quran which is matlu, the Quran that is recited, Nabiullah Muhammad is better than that. Yani Baqarah, Ali Imran, all this we're reading, Nabiullah Muhammad is better than it. As for the Quran, which is غيرو matlu, then he's better than the Prophet, which is the Quran present in Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. فَإِنَّوْ أَعْظَمُ مِنْهُ لِأَنَّ الْقَدِيمَ أَفْضَلُ مِنَ الْحَادِيثِ وَمَا شَعَلَ لِسِنَتِهِ. That's what he says. So ashaa'ira, what do they believe? The Quran is makhluq. Shahid, I just want to say something. What is the difference between ashaa'ira and the Mu'tazila then? This is what the Mu'tazila believed. Why have they got an issue with the Mu'tazila? The reason why they do is because the ashaa'ira have two Qurans and the Mu'tazila only have one Quran, and they refer to that one Quran as makhluq. Ashaa'ira are like, ya Mu'tazila, oh Mu'tazila, when you say the Quran is makhluq, you're referring to also the one that's present in Allah. And you shouldn't have. If you guys just said the one that we have is makhluq, the one that we have right now in front of us is makhluq, and you said the one with Allah is not makhluq, you would have saved yourself a lot of problems. We already proved there's no such a thing as kalam that's within you that doesn't come out, that doesn't exist based on evidence that I mentioned. If you want to look more into this issue, by the way, I could have brought more references. Go to the Kitab Al-Juwayni Al-Irshad. He mentions that in more details. If you want to look more into it, recently there's a scholar who passed away. His name is called Muhammad Sa'id Ramadan Al-Buti. There's a Kitab called Kubriyat Al-Yaqiniyat Al-Kawniyah, which is a book he wants to prove Allah's existence, and he divided the book into four, where he talks about al-ilahiyat, wal-nubuwat, al-kawniyat, al-ghaybiyat. He mentions it there, the difference between him and the Mu'tazila in this issue, because he has to explain it to the people. Also, if you go to the kitab Sharh al-Aqaid al-Nasafiyya, which is authored by Sa'aduddin al-Taftazani, or kitab al-Insaf by Baqilani, you'll find them speaking about this issue in great details, where the difference between them and the Mu'tazila is. Go there, inshallah ta'ala, talabat al-ilm, look at these people, what they believe. Ashaa'ira today are Jahmiyyah. They're Jahmiyyah. They are not Ashaa'ira like the early Ashaa'ira that were at the time of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, where you believed. No. The Ashaa'ira today are Jahmiyyah mahab. Wallahi, it's a podcast. Of course, it's not a series where I'm speaking about it in great details. I can bring you so much more.
Okay, I want to bring it back to a foundational level now. For the layman Muslim who's watching it, what is the issue with saying the Quran is created? What is the issue with that?
Saying the Quran is created is saying Allah's characteristics is created, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's characteristics, speech, sifatun min sifatillah, can't be created. How can it be created? Allah is not created, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's dangerous. وَلِذَٰلِكَ the salafu هَذِي الْأُمَّةِ like Ahmad and Shafi'i and Layth ibn Sa'd al-Awza'i, great scholars of Islam, what did they say? Man qala, anyone who says the Quran is makhluq, fawa kafir. If you want to see more statements like that, go to the kitab Khalqu Afa'ali al-Ibad. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah divided that book into two. The first part, he speaks about Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala, the statement of the Jahmiyyah and the Mu'tazila, where they said the Quran is makhluq. He refutes them, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. Okay? And he proves that that statement is kufrun billahi al-aliyyu al-azim. Then the second part, he speaks about the issue of the actions of the creation is created. He goes and speaks about that. Shahid, we have to understand the most important reason why we are in this world today. Allah brought us into this world is to know Tawheed. It's the purpose why we're here. This things that we're talking about is our reason of existence. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. All of the prophets that were sent to their nations, and every prophet that was sent to these people, he was told to say to them, أَنْ يَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاشِبَ اللَّهَ alone, وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ, and stay away from associating partners with Allah. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala also told us that Nuh alayhi salam, when he came to his people, Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَى قَوْمِي فَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرِهِ. He said to them, مَالَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرُهُ. You have no other ilah other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. Don't worship him. Allah also told us, Ad, when he went to his people, he said to the same thing, وَإِلَىٰ عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ هُودًا قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَالَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرُهُ. Same thing, Shu'aib, Salih, Musa, Isa all said to their people, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدُونِ. That's our reason in this world. The Prophet ﷺ, because of this, he said, I will fight. He said, أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى يشهدوا أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله ويقيم الصلاة ويؤتوا الزكاة فإذا فعلوا ذلك عصموا مني دماءهم وأموالهم إلا بحق الإسلام وحسابهم على الله تعالى. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated that. He said, I was commanded to fight with the people until they bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah and that Muhammad is his messenger, and they establish the prayer and they give the zakat. If they do that, their blood is sacred from me, their wealth is sacred from me, and their accountability is with Allah يوم القيامة. When the Prophet ﷺ sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he said to Mu'adh, when you come to these people, فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ شَهَادَةً لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. Let the first thing you call them to be what? لا إله إلا الله. If they obey that from you, then salah. وَهَكَذَا. One day, the Prophet ﷺ, he came to the noble sahabi, Ubay ibn Ka'b. And Imam Muslim narrated this. Ubay is a qari, a reciter of the Qur'an. The Prophet said to him one day, Ya Aba al-Mundir, that's his kunya. He said, Atadri ayyu ayatin min kitabillahi. Do you know what verse in the book of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, ma'aka azam? Do you know the greatest verse of the Quran that you have with you? He said, Qultu Allahu Rasulu alam. Allah and his messenger know. He said, Ya Aba al-Mundir, Atadri ayyu ayatin min kitabillahi ma'aka azam. The Prophet repeated a second time. He said, do you know the greatest verse that you have in the Quran? That's great. He then said, Ubay, Allah la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum, ayatul kursi. Fadaraba fi sadri Abu al-Mundir, Ubay ibn Ka'b, he said, the Prophet hit my chest. And he said, wallahi la yahnika al-ilm Abu al-Mundir. Allah is going to make knowledge pleasant for you, Mundir. Shahid, we have to understand this ayah, it talks about Allah's characteristics. More than 10 parts in that verse, it goes back to dhamair that goes back to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, pronouns that go back to Allah. We were commanded to know Allah's names and attributes. Allah said in the Quran, wa'alamu anna Allaha sami'un alim. Know that Allah hears and that He's got knowledge. Allah also says, wa'alamu anna Allaha ya'lamu ma fi anfusikum fahadharu. Wa'alamu anna Allaha ghafurur rahim. Wattaqu Allaha wa'alamu anna Allaha ma'al muttaqin. Fa'alamu anna Allaha azizun hakim. We've been told multiple times, know that Allah can hear all things. Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the pious people. Know that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is aziz, one who whatever He wants will happen the way He wants it. Hakim, He's wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa'alamu know anna Allah ghafurun halim, that Allah is forgiving and that He is halim. The characteristics of Allah. Rather, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala told us in the Quran the reason why He brought us into this world. He says, Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawati ومن الأرض مثلهن يتنزل الأمر بينهن لتعلموا أن الله على كل شيء قدير وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. Allah is saying, I created seven heavens, I created seven earths, and everything that's within it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, why? لتعلموا, so you can know أن الله على كل شيء قدير وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. The reason why I did all of that and I created all of those things is so you have knowledge of Allah's names and attributes. Allah also says subhanahu wa ta'ala, جعل الله الكعبة البيت الحرام قياما للناس والشهر الحرام والهدي والقلائد ذلك لتعلموا أن الله يعلم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وأن الله بكل شيء عليم. So you know that Allah knows everything that's in the seven heavens. Allah knows everything that's in the seven earths. وأن الله بكل شيء عليم. And that Allah has encompassed everything with knowledge. Shahid, He's saying, I created you for this reason. I brought you into this world for this reason. The one thing, the thing that Allah brought us into this world for, which is to have knowledge of Him and to worship Him alone, which are the two things. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Those are the two things Allah mentioned in the Quran that He created us for. Ashaa'ira have forsaken those. I haven't spoken about their concept of ibadah and the shirk that they've fallen into, the major shirk that they dwell into. I haven't even gone into that. Volumes have been written on these people and their corrupted belief and their ideology. It shocks me that someone will still attribute themselves to these group. Maybe it's because they don't know the group. Maybe they haven't heard these things. Because I did say to you, what they teach to the people and what they teach in maqam al-ta'alim is different. They teach something different in the circles of knowledge. And what they teach to amatul nas is different. So if you call yourself an ash'ari, today let it be the last day you refer to yourself as ash'ari. Say, I'm free from this group. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah for forgiveness and rectify your situation. That's what I can say, wallah.
We've just spent approximately an hour and a half talking about these very complex theological aspects and issues, when to be honest with you, most of the people and most of the Muslims that are living in the world today, it goes over their head. They don't really understand this. Whether they're Ash'ari or whether they're not Ash'ari, they don't really fully understand this for many reasons. Like you said, maybe they're not taught it. Why do you feel that it's so important to press on these issues, which probably were the number one controversy 600, 700 years ago at the time of Ibn Taymiyyah? And the reason why he wrote his books on Aqeedah based on these issues is because this was the issues that the people at the time were talking about. Now we have issues like feminism, atheism, secularism, evolution. If Ibn Taymiyyah was living in the 21st century, do you really think he'd be talking about the complex aspects of Kalamullah? Or would he be actually talking about feminism, atheism, evolution?
If the amatul nas don't know these issues, they shouldn't attribute themselves to an ideology. They don't really know its reality. You shouldn't call yourself an ash'ari if you don't know what the ash'ari believe. Now that, alhamdulillah, I'm hoping a lot of them have now come to know about it, free yourself from this group. Say, I've got nothing to do with it. I don't want to study that. I'm not an ash'ari. Distance yourself from them. They are a corrupt group. That's point number one. Point number two, and it's very important that you understand this point. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, ma'a jalalatihi wa makanati, we love him, we admire him, we know he defended this religion with his blood and sweat, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he did, and with his pen. But Ibn Taymiyyah, he's not an evidence, and he's not a proof in and within himself. I'm saying that because a lot of these people believe that we believe Ibn Taymiyyah is the ultimate evidence for us. We don't believe that. Ibn Taymiyyah, yusib wa yukhti. He can get it right and get it wrong. And if he gets it right, we'll take it from him. If he gets it wrong, we will dismiss it and not take it from him. That's First of all, something I want you to understand.
Fine.
So just because Ibn Taymiyyah did something, it doesn't necessarily mean the case. But that said, with that being said, what Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah proved, and I also tried my best to point it out in this podcast, is that the arguments against liberalism, the arguments against feminism, all these isms that we're hearing today, comes back to, is the Qur'an and the Sunnah a source of legislation? Which nearly 1,000 years ago was the battle where it started from. A group of people who did not go back to the Qur'an and the Sunnah as a proof. The mas'ala here, Shahid, and the argument here is always been this. And I've said this to you before. It is a mas'ala that they've passed one onto the other. Let me read a statement to you that Al-Imam As-Sam'ani said, Abu Mudhaffar As-Sam'ani, who died in 489. He said it then. He said in his Kitab Al-Intisar, li Ashab Al-Hadith. Abu Mudhaffar As-Sam'ani, Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi said about him in Sayyid Al-Alam Al-Nubala, he said, Al-Imam Al-Allamatu Mufti Khurasan, Shaykh Al-Shafi'iyyah. Shaykh Al-Shafi'iyyah. He said, wa'alam no, anna fasla ma baynana wa bayna al-mubtadi'ati huwa mas'alatu al-aql. The dispute, argumentation, the issue between us and the innovators is the issue of logic, rationality. فَإِنَّهُمْ أَسَّسُوا دِينَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَعْقُولِ. They base their religion on logic. وَجَعَلُوا الْإِتِّبَاعَ وَالْمَأْثُورَ تَبْعَى لِلْمَعْقُولِ. And they made the Quran and the Sunnah follow their logic. وَأَمَّا أَهْلُ السُّنَّةِ. The people of the Sunnah. قَالُوا. They said, الْأَصْلُ الْإِتِّبَاعَ. The أَصَّلُ is to follow. وَالْعُقُولُ تَبَعٌ. And the logic needs to follow the Quran and the Sunnah. وَلَوْ كَانَ أَسَاسُ الدِّينِ عَلَى الْمَعْقُولِ. He says, if the religion was based on rationality and all only just use your mind, لَسْتَغْنَ الْخَلْقُ عَنِ الْوَحِي. The people will not need revelation. وَعَنِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. The people will not need the prophets. صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِمْ. May Allah peace and salutation be upon them. وَلَا بَطَلَ مَعْنَ الْأَمْرِ وَالنَّهِي. And the commands and the prohibitions that are coming to us from Allah and His Messenger would have no weight. وَلَقَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ مَا شَاءَ. And everybody would claim whatever they wanted. Shahid, if you look at that one statement of Abu Mudhaffar As-Sam'ani, all of the groups, that's what should we have. You come to a feminist, hardcore, yani, whether she's a progressive feminist or this, what do you call it, conservative feminist, whatever she calls herself. The issue is al-idhan wal-khudu' li-nusus al-wahyin. Submit to the Quran and Sunnah. What are you looking for, sister? Hurriya, freedom. The hurriya should be it should be restricted. It should be narrowed down by Allah and His Messenger. No. I have to look for it in this organization. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. The battle is مَسْأَلَةُ الْعَقْلِ. مَسْأَلَةُ الْهَوَى. ذوق. I feel this. I like this. I enjoy this. It goes politics being put before the Quran and Sunnah. يعني what you feel and you put it before the Quran and Sunnah. عقل before the Quran and the Sunnah. يعني this has been the battle. And it seems to be still the battle.
Okay.
Now we've been saying from then until now, may Allah make us from Ahlus-sunnah. Say ameen. الدين قال الله قال رسول قال الصحابة هم أولو العرفان ما العلم نصبك للخلاف سفاهة بين الرسول وبين رأي فلان. Our religion, inshallah ta'ala, is to say قال الله قال الرسول. Allah said and His Messenger said and the companion said. That's what our religion has been. We don't mention anything from ourselves. We know our statements has no value, no meaning. Has nothing.
Okay, let me turn your argument back onto yourself then. If you are saying and you're sitting here and claiming that the Ashaa'ira do not even put the Quran and Sunnah at the forefront, they put the Aql over it, they reject the Quran and Sunnah openly, then if they reject the Masadir al-Talaqi, why don't you make takfir of them? Bila iqamat al-Hujjah. Without establishing the proof, they rejected the Nusus al-Wahyain. Why do you still say they're Muslims, they're misguided Muslims? Why do you make takfir of them?
Because, again, that's another thing. Qadiyatul takfir, it needs us to have another podcast on it. What makes a person takfir? How do you shurut takfir? You know, takfir al-mutlaq, general takfir, specific tafsir, specific takfir. That I think we've kind of touched on that on one of the previous.
Yeah.
Okay, briefly. That's another issue. Lakin. Ashaa'ira and the group that they are today, And then Asha'ira, they went through their stages. I told you before, Abu Bakr al-Baqillani, what he believed is not necessarily what Abu Mu'al al-Juwayni believes, and not what Abu Hamid al-Ghazali believes, and not what Fakhruddin al-Razi believes. So because many people don't know the Ash'ari belief, they don't know it, haven't studied it, they claim to be part of this group. I know, inshallah, many people's, after hearing this, who are passionate about the religion, who might attribute themselves to Ash'ariyah, after watching this, inshallah ta'ala, a lot of them are sincere. I know a lot of who are sincere. When they watch this, it'll be a sadma, be shocked, and they'll be taken back. And they will be, idhnillahi al-kareem, change their ways.
Nah. Do you think you tend to overcomplicate aqeedah? For example, when Munkar and Nakira are asking the people in the grave, Marrabbuk, the Ash'ari will say, Allah. And the Athari will say, Allah. What's the issue? Allah is not going to ask you, what is the meaning of istiwa, what is the meaning of yad? He's not going to, what is the Quran created? He's not going to ask you these things. Do you think you tend to overcomplicate Ash'ariyah?
Shahid, the scholars already mentioned this before. Al-ilmum, before, knowledge used to be a nuqta, it was a dot. Katharah al-juhal, the ignorant people made this so many dots. What I mean by that is that Ahlus-sunnah did not bring these technicalities, and they were not the ones who brought these arguments like that. They were just saying, قال الله, they were reading the verse of Ayat al-Sifat, and they were fine. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, groups popped up. And they said, like what happened, the hadith of Jibreel, when the Qadariyah came out, and Ma'bad al-Juhani, for example, and he said, Allah Qadr, there's no Qadr, wa anna al-amra unuf. And that wasn't there before. No one ever said that before. And then Ma'bad al-Juhani just said it like that. But then Ghailan al-Dimashqi took it from him, and he played around with it more, you know, thought about this issue, and then brought arguments forward. And then Ahlus-Sunnah responded. And then the speech became more because of that. And every time they said something, Ahlus-Sunnah would respond. And they will respond. Lakin Ahlus-Sunnah were never the ones to bring the points forward. They'll stick to the Quran. They'll leave it at the bare minimum. And whenever they speak more, they add on more to clarify this and more to clarify this. Do you understand my point?
As they add on more and more, are they not developing the aqeedah to a level that the companions didn't understand it because there was no need to understand it? For example, the Qadr, like you brought up. We now say that there's four pillars of the Qadr. The knowledge, the writing, the word, the creation. The companions didn't understand it like this.
No, but that's my point. But it doesn't mean the concept of the Sahabas would be wrong. Like when they look at it, Sahabas would agree that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, for example, the Qadr, Allah's knowledge, that Allah knows everything. وعنده مفاتيح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هو ويعلم ما في البر والبحر وما تسقط من ورقة إلا يعلمها ولا حبة في ظلمات الأرض ولا رطب ولا يابس إلا في كتاب مبين. They know that knowledge. Okay, good. Everything's written. Oh yeah, they'll accept that. They, the Sahabas, had the Qur'an innately built in them. لَسْتُ بِنَحْوِيٍّ يَلُوكُ لِسَانَهُ وَلَكِنِّي سَرِيقِيٌّ أَقُولُ فَأُعْرِبُ. As the poet said, I'm not a grammarian. I'm an Arab. Okay? I don't need to say مُبْتَدَأٌ مَرْفُوعٌ جَاءٌ Sorry. For example, قَامَ For example, مُحَمَّدٌ مُجْتَهِدٌ I don't have to say this مُبْتَدَأٌ مُحَمَّدٌ مُبْتَدَأٌ مَرْفُوعٌ وَعَلَامَةُ رَفْعِ ضَمَّةٌ ظَاهِرَةٌ عَلَى آخِرِ هي مجتهد okay خبر مرفوع. He doesn't need to say that. He said I'm a نحوي. I'm a grammarian. لست بنحوي يلوك لسانه. I don't need to look for the I say it and it's grammatically correct. Also وأول من ألف في الكتب محمد بن شافع المطلب وغيره كان له سريقة مثل الذي العربي من الخليقة أصول الفقه عام خاص مطلق مقيد مجمل مبين. The Sahabas don't need that. They innately know that. They know it. They used it without giving it those names. They were saying it without giving those titles to it. So the Aqeedah Ahlus-Sunnah only explained it further because of the people's knowledge, of course, decreasing, and also because of the innovators becoming large in number. Shahid. That doesn't mean like they introduced new concepts. That's where the issue is. They didn't. They expanded on what it meant. وَلِذَلِكَ there's a kitab called فَضْلُ عِلْمِ السَّلَفِ عَلَى عِلْمِ الْخَلَفِ Ibn Rajab wrote, where he talks about the knowledge of the early scholars, يعني صحابة رسول الله, the تابعين, the تابعين التابعين, how they spoke very little, and so, and now when we get that, we have to unpackage it for so much. Why are we going to have to? Why is it going to take us 2-3 volumes?
And the Ash'ari who says that, for example, that the companions didn't need ilm al-kalam because they understood it easily, but the Mu'tazila came and they put another dot in, therefore we had to come with ilm al-kalam to refute them.
Ilm al-kalam. it's something mustawrat. It's something that's taken from the philosophers. It's taken from Aristotle. It's taken from Plato. This is the people we've taken it from. And that's where we're going to build our fundamental aqeedah on. I have to understand this is important. Usul al-fiqh is taken from Shafi'i, Imam min Aimatul Sunnah. Yani, where did he take it from? Yani, when we study the mabadi of every subject, inna, when the scholars, they say, inna, inna mabadi akulla fannin ashra, al-had wal-mawdu'u thumma thumra, wa nismatu nisba, wal-had, he says, inna mabadi akulla fannin ashra, al-had wal-mawdu'u thumma thumra, wa nisbatun wa ونسبة والواضع وحكم الاستمداد وحكم الشارع مسائل والمسائل للبعض اكتفى ومن دار الجميع حاز الشرفة. يعني where is the science taken from is one of the things that you study يعني in what is known as the mabadi of every science. علم الكلام that is taken from Greek logians, يعني people who يعني were atheists or يعني people who were non-Muslims. That's where these people take their religion from. For example, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, which I think inshallah ta'ala we should make a podcast for Sifatullah tabarak wa ta'ala, we speak about it. We really break down the concept of ta'wil and tafwid and all of these arguments that they bring forward. Lakin, when you come to Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, you have two great imams of Islam. You have, first of all, you got Ibn Abbas's tafsir on this issue. You've got Mujahid's tafsir on this issue. You've got Abu Ali's tafsir on this issue, which Bukhari chose. Bukhari chose both Mujahid and Abu Ali's qawl. Ala wartafa, he brought them together in his tafsir. Okay. Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa ala wartafa ala wartafa. Mujahid said that. Mujahid is the man who Sufyan al-Thawri said, "Idha ja'aka tafsir Mujahid, idha ja'aka tafsir Mujahid fahasbuka bih." We have Abu Aliya who says also a commentary on this verse. They abandon that. They leave Mujahid. They leave Abu Aliya. They leave the tafsir of these great imams, and who do they go to? They go to a man who's not a Muslim, Ghayath ibn Ghayuth al-Salt. Who said, استوى بشر على العراق من غير سيف ولا دم مهراق. He says, استوى بشر على العراق. بشر took over Iraq. من غير سيف, without any sword, ولا دم مهراق, and no blood was spilled. So they said, استوى, here means استولى. Hey, where did you get it from? غياث بن غيوث السلطة, he said this. Who is this guy? He's a guy who doesn't believe in Allah. But the point is that he said it. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah refuted that. Like, we've got Aimatul Sunnah.
Jahiliya poetry, for example, at the time of the Arabs, like, it is a proof in the law.
First
right?
of all, he was not one of the people's language is taken as proof. Second is that no one's ever said, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa ala, in the context of istawa, no Arab. Any Arab, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to bring the kalam if we get a session for it. Al-Arabi and others said, and I'll bring the ijma' of Abu Amr al-Talmaki, who said that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, by unanimous agreement, Ahlus-sunnah, all unanimously agree that Allah is above his throne. They're going to leave the ijma'. They're going to leave the ayat, Aminu man fi sama, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, Ayn Allah fi sama, i'tiqha fa inna mu'mina. And all those hadith, they're going to twist it, break it, push it, ignore it. All of these, I really want people to understand it's not just there's a tafsir problem here, and there's an odd, you know, disagreement here, and it's just, you know, generally they like the Quran, generally they love the hadith. Let's really call out the situation as it is, and not sugarcoat it. Ashaa'ira today are Jahmiyyah. Anyone ذاق طعم العلم, who tasted the sweetness of knowledge, أما شم رائحة العلم, even if he didn't taste it but he smelt it from far, he will know Ashaa'ira today are Jahmiyyah. Lakin, when you don't know and you don't have understanding, whenever somebody says these statements, like I'm saying right now, the Jahmiyyah are, the Ashaa'ira are Jahmiyyah, you start to hate that person. As the poet said, من جهل شيئا عاداه, Ali ibn Abi Talib said, من جهل شيئا عاداه عاد أهله. If you have an ignorance of something, you show animosity to the people who show you the truth. You don't like them. You call them names, you belittle them. The Diobandiya community in the UK, for example, who adopt these ideologies, a lot of them I've sat with.
Okay.
I've sat with a lot of these people. I said, look, Akhi, do you believe these issues, right? First I said, do you believe in these books? Jawharatu Tawheed by Burhanuddin Ibrahim al-Laqani. Do you believe in it? Yes, I do. Okay, do you believe in Sunusi's Kutubs? Yes, I do. Okay, do you believe in this? Do you believe in this? Ha. Yaakhi, these are the things that are written it. Wallahi, billahi, tallahi. All these books I'm telling you, wallahi, I never read it from other references. I started and I finished it just for this podcast. Just for this podcast. I read it before. Shahid, wallahi, wa billahi, wa tallahi. Majority of them, I agree, they don't know it. Why are you attributing yourself to a group you don't know? You don't even understand it. And then when you get caught out and I tell you this is what your group says and they believe, if you then start defending it, there's something wrong with you. I genuinely were excused at the beginning. You didn't know. Okay, no problem. Now you know. Why are you still arguing for it? Why are you debating for it? Are you with me?
Yeah.
So that's the problem, wallahi.
So to take it back to the layman on the street, aside from the people that, you know, you're speaking to, the people of knowledge, the layman on the street, if, for example, he is upon the fitrah in terms of names and attributes of Allah, he believes Allah has mercy, he doesn't really go further than that, he doesn't ask about the speech of Allah too much, but he attributes himself to the Ash'ari madhab.
He knows the Ash'ari, what they are and what they believe, he's in trouble. He's in trouble. If he doesn't know, then why is he attributing himself to a group he doesn't know? It's like me saying, "Akhi, I'm a Jew, but you know, I only worship Allah." Out of cave. How are you going to attribute yourself to a group? By the way, I'm not saying that Ash'ari are Jews. What I'm saying is that attributing yourself to a group, you have to know their beliefs. I want to say something to you. They say all these issues are very trivial issues. Why are you wasting your time on it? They say that, right?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay, why do they not say the same thing about ISIS and those people? They have Khawarij tendencies. Khawarij was actually the first group that ever came out. The Musam al-Iman was a discussion.
I think that what the claim is that these issues are historically, like the controversies in the past that are dead and buried. Why do you have to resurrect it? We agree that most of the Ash'ari don't know these things.
So why
do you have to teach them this?
So why
just to raise a controversy and then refute them? Just leave them.
Shahid, I believe majority of those people who say it, they are halalun ala balabirihi dawhu halalul tayr min kulli jinsi. They have double standards. Al-kaylu bi mikalain wal waznu bi mizain.
Okay,
they have double standards. They have one scale for themselves and other scales for other people. When they say that they only are talking to the Salafis and they're saying to the Salafis, put your weapons down because we're fighting and we're in a jihad. Jihadul lisan, jihadul sinan, you're in a jihad. So they say, put the weapons down. Stop, calm down. And they go to the Ash'ari and say, spread what you want to spread. Majority of those are doing that. Like Salafi was ghayurun ala sunnah. Why is he going to leave it? Man ra'a minkum munkaran falyughayyirhu biyadi fa illam yastati' fa bilisani fa illam yastati' fa biqalbi wa dhalika adha'afu al-iman. One of the things that was mentioned is Abu Bakr al-Baqillani, who was min al-mutakallimin, from the Ash'ari. Abu Hamid al-Isra'ini, whenever they lived in the same place, he used to wear niqab. I want you to understand, Abu Bakr Baqillani was very smart, clever. If you look at his debates with the Christians and everything, subhanAllah, ta'ajjab. Abu Hamid al-Isra'ini made him wear niqab, billahi alayk. When he went to call of nature outside, he would hide from Abu Hamid al-Isra'ini because he called him out. He shamed him. He literally exposed his ideology. He didn't personally attack him, but he exposed his ideology where he couldn't live. He was hiding. He was in the hiding. So Salafis should be like that with Ahlul Bidah. They should never stop from putting pressure on them. The second thing, Akhi, is that they themselves are hunting down the Salafis. They go, they open the works of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and they bring it out. Wallahi, if they brought something out, we would be the first person to condemn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab if he came with something wrong.
What about the man in the middle who says, Ash'ari, you should stop going at the Salafis. And a Salafi, you should stop going at the Ash'ari.
No,
weapons down.
We're happy. We say ala ru'usil ashhad. We say in the open to everyone who's listening. Anything, go look into our books. Alhamdulillah, we're happy. Go into our books without lying, without deception. Go to the ulama that we consider to be scholars and bring out half of what I mentioned today in this podcast. Don't be kadhib al iftira'at that was made against Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Kadhib. Ibn Battuta, for example, lied about Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah in issues that he claimed Ibn Taymiyyah said, when he never even met Ibn Taymiyyah. So don't bring me kalam that is kadhib and made up and forged against the scholars of Islam. Bring me something in their works. I'm mentioning from works they admit it's their works.
But do you think this issue, this complex theological issue, is even worth talking about in this?
Long as one person believes in it, no. لا يهدي الله بك رجل واحد خير لك من حمر النعم. For Allah to guide one person on your hand is better than you than a red camel. As long as there's one person on the face of this earth who believes in the Ash'ari ideology, I don't think anyone should stop talking about them. They should be exposed. They should be spoken about. They should be called out. They should be yani. And not to mention, in the UK, we have the biggest organizations, biggest masajids. How is someone going to be silent about that? We've got Drewsbury, where they teach these abatil and these ideologies to the people. We have that. We have it in the UK, colleges here and there that they teach in. Yani, can I just mention the names of great scholars of Islam who consider the Asha'ira to be from Ahlul Bidah?
Okay, fine.
The first one is Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Some of you might say, but Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, how? Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he made tabdi' of the Kullabiyyah. And he was very harsh on the Kullabiyyah. And the Asha'ira to al-Awa'il, the early Asha'ira, are what? Abu al-Hasan himself, direct, benefited from the, yani, from Ibn Kullab. He benefited from him. ولذلك أحمد بن حنبل, as it was mentioned by Imam Abu Bakr ibn Khuzaima, as it's a Sirah Alam ibn Nubala, he mentions that Ali, Abu Ali al-Thaqafi, he said, مَا الَّذِي أَنْكَرْتَ أَيُّهَا الْأُسْتَاذِ مِنْ مَذْهَبِنَا حَتَّى نَرْجِعَ عَنْهُ. He said, مَيْلُكُمْ إِلَى مَذْهَبِ الْكُلَّابِيَّةِ فَقَدْ كَانَ أَحْمَدُ بْنُ حَنْبَلٍ أَشَدُّ النَّاسِ عَلَى عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنُ سَعِيدِ بْنُ كُلَّابٍ وَعَلَى أَصْحَابِ مِثْلَ الْحَارِثِ وَغَيْرِهِ. Ahmad was very harsh on al-Harith al-Muhasibi. But what did he say? He commanded the people to boycott him. And he warned the people from him. And he said to them, stay away from him. Ahmad ibn Hanbal. The Kullabiyyah is the yani, Aqeedah that Asha'ira took on. Asha'ira just became famous for it. Al-Imam Abu Nasr al-Sijzi, who I mentioned before, that they had been praised. He yani, spoke against the Asha'ira in his kitab, Al-Raddu ala man ankara al-sawta, ala man ankara al-harf wa-sawt. Page 100 and 101. Go there and look at it. He mentions that about the Asha'ira, and they are misguided people. Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Khuwayz Mindad al-Misri al-Maliki, Ibn Abdul Barr mentions this in his kitab Jami' Bayan al-Ilmi wa Fadli. And I'm going to read this statement, it's very powerful. Annahu, that he said, Annahu qala fi kitab al-shahadati fi ta'wil qawli Malikin. Al-Imam Malik said, La tajuzu shahadatu ahli al-bida'i wa ahli al-ahwa. The testimony and the witnessing of the people of innovation is not accepted. Now, Imam Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Khuwayz Mindad al-Misri, he wants to explain who are these people that Ahmad Malik is talking about. He said, Ahlul Ahwa'i inda Malikin, the people of innovation to Malik ibn Anas, wasa'ira ashabina and us, Malikiyya, which is another refutation of those who claim that the majority of the people are what?
Asha'ira.
He's saying, Ibn Abdul Barr transmitted this in his Jami' Bayan al-Ilm al-Fadli. He's saying us and the Malikiyya. And Ibn Abdul Barr is a Maliki. Ibn Aimat al-Malikiyya is one of the greatest explanations of the kitab.
He was Ash'ari, right?
Who?
Ibn Abdul Barr.
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un.
No.
Allahu Akbar. No. Min Aimat al-Sunnah he was. Ibn Abdul Barr. There's a nice refutation on them. He's quoting, look, the statement. How's he going to be Ash'ari? He's bringing the statement of another Imam of the Maliki Madhab. Pay attention here. He's saying the statement of Al-Imam Malik where he said لا تجوز شهادة أهل البدع, the testimony of the people of innovation is not accepted, وأهل الأهواء. He's saying Ibn Khuwayz Mindad al-Misri saying Al-Maliki أهل الأهواء عند مالك, according to Al-Imam Malik, the people of innovation وسائر أصحابنا, also us Malikiyya, is whom أهل الكلام, is the people of أهل الكلام. For kullu mutakallimin, every person of ilmu al-kalam, fa huwa min ahli al-ahwa wal bid'ah, he's from the people of innovation. Ash'ariyan kana, whether he's an ash'ari or ghayra ash'ariyin, or whether he's not an ash'ari. Wa la tuqbalu lahu shahadatun fil islami, his testimony should never be accepted. Wa yuhjar, he should be boycotted. Wa yu'addab, he should be disciplined ala bid'ati, in his innovation. Fa in tamada, if he's stubborn and he's still hard-headed on that issue, istutiba minha, he's requested to repent from this. Shahid, look at this point. He's saying here that we Malikiyya, this is what we believe. The Malik statement is referring to the Sha'ara. That's what he's saying. Ibn Qudama, rahimahullah, look what he said. Ibn Qudama, he has a kitab, in his kitab, Al-Munadarat fil Quran, page 35, he says, وَلَا نَعْرِفُ فِي أَهْلِ الْبِدَعِ. Shahid, this is very shocking. He said, we don't know in the people of innovation, طائفة, a group, يكتمون مقالتهم, who hide their statements, who conceal their views, ولا يتجاسرون, who don't then come out in the public and ala idhariha, who don't come out in the open to tell the people about it, illa zanadiqat wal ash, illa zanadiqat wal ash'ariyah, except the zanadiqa, the heretics, and the ash'ara. The ash'ara are the people who hide their statements from you. Ibn Qudama is saying this. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Also, he said in the kitab kitab Tahrim al-Nadhar fi kutub al-kalam, he said, وَقَالَ أَحْمَدُ بْنُ إِسْحَاقَ الْمَالِكِ أَهْلُ الْأَهْوَاءِ وَالْبِدَعِ عِنْدَ أَصْحَابِنَا. Again, they claim they're the most in number. Ibn Qudama is saying that Ahmad ibn Ishaq al-Maliki said, أهل الأهواء, people of innovation, والبدع من عند أصحابنا, according to us, and عند الحلابلة, عند المالكي, again, sorry, is whom أهل الكلام, is the people of كلام. فكل متكلم من أهل الأهواء, every single person who's from أهل الكلام is what? Every person who's من أهل الكلام is what? من أهل الأهواء والبدع. أشعريا كان, whether he's an أشعري or غير أشعري, or whether he's not, لا تقبل له شهادة. شهادة, his testimony should never be accepted. He should be boycotted the same. He should be disciplined for his innovation. And if he's stubborn and he's hard-headed, he's told to repent from that. Fifth person, Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini. Who is Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini? He's min a'immati shafi'iyya, and he's considered to be from the ashab al-wujuh. يعني if his khilaaf is mu'tabar fi madhab al-shafi'i. Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini. Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini was very harsh with Baqilani and those who were with him. And he really gave them a hard time. That it was mentioned, Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini was so harsh on Abu Bakr al-Baqilani that he will go out with a niqab, khawfa min al-Shaykh Abi Hamid al-Isfrayini. All of this because he's scared of who? Abu Hamid al-Isfrayini. Also, Abu Ismail Abdullah.
Last one, and I'm going to have to stop you.
It's 16, but I'll stop there, inshallah. Abu Ismail Abdullah ibn Muhammad al-Ansari. He mentions it in his kitab. Subki mentions this, by the way. Subki, who they look up to,
yeah,
mentions in his tabaqat that he said, when he spoke about it, that he used to, annahu kana yal'anu Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. He used to curse Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. Wa annahu taraka al-riwayata an shaykh al-qadhi Abi Bakr al-Hiri. And Abu Ismail al-Harawi left off narrating from his teacher al-qadhi Abi Bakr al-Hiri because he was an Ash'ari. ولذلك, there's a story, Ibn Qudama and Abu Amr, who both of whom used to study with a man by the name of Al-Qadhi ibn Asrun. Al-Qadhi ibn Asrun was the Qadhi al-Qudat for Nuruddin Mahmud Zenki, rahimahullah ta'ala. He was the Qadhi al-Qudat. So what happened? Ibn Qudama and Abu Umar, both of them, who are brothers, who are the children of Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, both of them used to study with him. And so news reached them that this man that they study with, Ibn Asrun, Qadhi ibn Asrun, is an Ash'ari. So they left him. So he saw them one day, he saw Abu Amr specifically, and he said to him, hey, why did you stop coming to my classes? He goes, I heard that you're an Ash'ari. I heard that you are an Ash'ari. And then he said, wallahi, I'm not an Ash'ari. But wallahi, if you stay with me for 1 year and you seek knowledge of fiqh from me, wallahi, you're going to be a scholar in fiqh. And he sought knowledge of fiqh from him. A point, Shahid, to you is that, wallahi, I'm just going to mention the names, I'm not going to quote them. Muhammad ibn Abdul Malik ibn Muhammad ibn Umar ibn Muhammad al-Karji, Abu al-Hasan al-Shafi'i, he considered them to be from the Ahlul Bid'ah. Al-Qahtani, in his Nuniyah, he says, Ya Asha'iratu, Ya Asafilat al-Wara, Ya Umyun, Ya Summun bila Adhani, Inni la'ubghidhukum wa ubghidhu hizbakum, Bughdan aqallu qalilihi adghani, Law kuntu a'mal muqlatayni lasarrani, كي لا يرى إنسانكم إنساني. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, who is the ninth imam, he considered them to be from the innovators and Ahlul Bid'ah. Also Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, A'imma da'wa al-Najdiyah, like Sulaiman ibn Sahman, 11. Also Abu Abutayn is min A'imma da'wa al-Najdiyah, 12. Number 13 is Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, who considered them to be from Ahlul Bid'ah. Also Imam Al-Faqih Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, who considered them to be from Ahlul Bid'ah. And number 15 is Sheikh Salih Al-Fawzan, who when he was asked, are the Asha'ira and the Maturidiyah, are they from Ahlus-sunnah? And he said, لا يعدون من Ahlus-sunnah. We should not consider them to be from the people of the Sunnah. He said, no one considers them to be from Ahlus-sunnah. They're the ones who call themselves Ahlus-sunnah. They're not from Ahlus-sunnah.
Okay. I think it's been very comprehensive. The quotes that you brought from the ulama at the end towards the end, I think someone could quite easily say that these are scholars on your side, we have scholars on our side. But the most impressive thing, I think, was the quotes you brought from their scholars, which was the main part of the podcast. I want to talk, I think you comprehensively proved that the Asha'ira of today are not from Ahlus-sunnah. But I want to take it back to the origin of this. And I just want to, the last segment of this podcast, I want to rewind the clock and take it back to when these deviations first started taking place in Aqeedah. And you're talking about the time of Ibn Kulab, like you said, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, he took it from Ibn Kulab al-Muhasibi. You're talking about like the third century after Hijriah, the same time of Imam Ahmed Ibn Hanbal. These kind of deviations that are started from the very, and these are Sunni Islam as well. They both attribute themselves to Sunni Islam. These deviations that occurred here, why can't we just say that these were the early generations, the generation of Islam, which were the most virtuous, the most knowledgeable, the most pious? Why can't we say that the differences that took place between them, we don't make inkar of either one of them, because it happened at the time of the quote-unquote Salaf?
Shahid, the names and the attributes of Allah, for example, is what you're referring to, Ahmed, Muhammad, and all these imams. The issue they had was this. I want you to understand something, that it really does go before Ahmed ibn Hanbal. The issue really goes back to Jahm ibn Safwan. Before him was Ja'ad ibn Dirham. Ja'ad ibn Dirham, he took from Aban ibn Sam'an. Aban ibn Sam'an took from Talut, and Talut took from Labid ibn al-A'sam, the man who did magic on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Labid ibn al-A'sam is the man all of this goes back to. Labid ibn al-A'sam gave it Talut. Talut gave it to Aban ibn Sam'an. Aban ibn Sam'an gave it to Ja'ad ibn Dirham. Ja'ad ibn Dirham gave it to who?
Jahm
ibn Safwan. And that's how it trickled into the mutakallimin that we see. When we say mutakallimin, we mean three. Maturidi, Asha'ira, and the Mu'tazila. Asha'ira, they got it from that. At the beginning, you have to understand, the Jahmiyyah went under excessive heat. So everybody was trying to avoid being connected to the Asha'ira, to the Jahmiyyah. The Jahmiyyah were not as educated and as scholastic as the Mu'tazila was. The Mu'tazila were learned, they were studied, they were grounded in knowledge, yeah, especially the Arabic language one and other sciences. So Wasi ibn Ata, Amr ibn Ubaid, and the likes of these people. And then Bishr al-Marisi came out, and then they took power. Shahid, they took power at the time of Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah ta'ala, which Ma'mun was being forced into by his Qadi al-Qudat. Ibn Du'ad made this whole issue become a test, testing it on the people. The point is that I'm trying to say to you is that Ahmed ibn Hanbal was still consistent upon the Prophet's way, and Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali. Anyone who's still on that path, he's not the one who's cutting away from the Jama'ah. He's not the one who's creating something. And Ahmed's Sanad goes back to who? It goes to Shafi'i, to Malik, Nafi', Ibn Umar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the sanad of Imam Ahmed. Ahmed took from Shafi'i. Shafi'i took from who? Imam Malik. Malik took from who? Nafi'. Nafi' took from who? Ibn Umar. Ibn Umar took from who? The Messenger alayhi wa sallam. That's the chain of Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Bishr al-Maris and these guys, their asanid is Dajjajila. Do you understand my point? So Ahmed's consistent upon that path, and till today, the people like this, because it's on that path. I ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala bimannihi wa karamihi, that Allah makes us from these people. Amen. Who are consistent upon that path. They're not the problem. They're just trying to keep it clean, pure, untainted. By saying to the people that there is more than one Ahlus Sunnah, it's takhidil. The Prophet can't count. The Prophet said, Sataftariqu ummati ala thalathin wa sab'ina nafra, kulluha fi nari illa wahida.
I'm not saying there's more than one Ahlus Sunnah. I'm saying Ahlus Sunnah itself, there is differences of Aqeedah within Ahlus Sunnah.
No.
The companion is different Aqeedah.
Look what the Prophet said. I just said to you, the Prophet said there are 73 groups in my Ummah. Sahih?
Mm-hmm.
72 of them are going to be in the Hellfire, and one group is going to be. Then the Prophet described that one group. He gave a description to the one group. What was the description he gave? I said, مَنْ كَانَ عَلَى مِثْلِ مَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمَ وَصْحَابِي. Anyone who's upon that which I and my companions are upon today. Are the Asha'ira, after this whole podcast of what I'm proving, are the Asha'ira upon that which the Prophet and his companions are upon? Did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, is istawla? No. Did the Prophet say يَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذِلُّ الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ? Did he say that to Allah? Did he say وَجَاءَ أَمْرُ رَبِّكَ? Did he say these ta'wilat batila that they came with? The Prophet said that, if he did, show it to us. Wallahi, we'll take it. We'll take it. This is the point. Did the Prophet وسلم, say that if the evidences or the logic and the evidences of the Quran go against each other, give precedence? Did the Prophet say this to the people?
No, but he also didn't say the other way around.
He said the opposite. He said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. If they are going to say no to the Quran, and if they're going to say no to the Sunnah, of course they're going to say no to Abu Bakr and Umar.
They're not saying no, but they're just trying to understand it a different way. And we haven't got the companions with us.
There was an example.
To ask them, what exactly do you believe about ta'wil and tafweed?
There was an example. Was it Wasim al-Ata? Was it Wasim al-Ata or Amr ibn Ubaid? One of them. He said, if something like this, I think it was Amr ibn Ubaid or Wasim al-Ata, one of the two. And if it's not, inshallah, somebody will correct me, inshallah ta'ala. He said, if the Prophet was to say this to me, I would not accept it from him. If Allah was to say to me this, I would have said, I would say to Allah, you did not worship me. So you did not enslave me to believe in this. And his statement like that, if Abu Bakr said this, I would not accept it from him. He said, if Sulaiman ibn Mihran said this to me, I would not accept it from him. He goes through the chain. If Fulan said this to me, I would not accept it from him. If the Prophet said to me, I would not accept it from him. If Allah said this to me, I would have said, this is not what you enslaved me on. Did you get my point?
Yeah.
Issue is not shahid. Again, and I keep pointing this point out, the issue is not these people, one issue flipped. It's a rare situation. It's a slight confusion here. It's no problem. It's not يعتقدون ثم يستدلون فيضلون. They believe. They look for evidences of what they believe, and then they get misguided from it. The Quran and the Sunnah, it's, of course, if I come today right now and I have a belief and I go to the Quran, I'm going to find something to go. I'm going to make that verse look like it's in my advantage. So you think, oh, he brought an ayah. Okay, mashallah. The premise and the way he's coming from is totally different. Ashaa'ira today, the people those who are ashaa'ira, and those who champion for them, I don't like mentioning names, but those who champion for them, look at them today. Are they people when they talk, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَلَى, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَلَى, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, are they like that? Do they teach the Tawaweenu Sunnah? Do they teach Riyadu Salihin, Bulugh al-Maram, Amdatu al-Hakam, Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah? I went to India and I met people from Dioband. And it's one of the biggest representation on the Sha'ari side, right? Sha'ari, if I tell you this, imagine. When I went to Al-Hadith and Jama' Salafiyah Banaras, I went there. Ya akhi, Bukhari, the Karim Bukhari, they're teaching Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Kutub Al-Hadith on their eyes. These people, it was added later. Yani, the thing is, the truth is, wallahi, you can't use this. The Sunnah is not that big to them. And that, if you're like that in Aqeedah, how are you going to be in Fiqh? Hadith wala haraj. Just go on.
Okay. I want to move on to some closing questions and then give you a chance to summarize. But before I do, I did raise the question that the companions differed in Aqeedah. And a lot of people use this to prove that it's okay for us also to have differences in Aqeedah. So what do you say about that?
A few points to stand over. Number one, can someone say, for example, the Sahabas never differed on issues of fiqh?
No, they can't say that.
But there are fiqh issues which they never differed on.
Correct. But when you say that statement, it looks like they differed on the whole of fiqh.
Exactly.
Okay.
That's important that you understand.
So they didn't differ on the whole of Aqeedah.
So they didn't differ. When you say that, it seems like you can differ in any issues of Aqeedah. Aqeedah has usul. And it has issues of furu'. There are very small issues in Aqeedah which are furu'. They're not fundamental issues. Yes, they differ on those issues. So it's better to say furu' sharia and then usul. So the usul they differ upon. The furu' they differ upon. And the usul they never differ upon. The usul can be issues of fiqh and it can be issues of Aqeedah. That's an important point that you understand. And those issues of furu' that they differed upon itself hata can be discussed and looked into. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ A person can look at, into it, inshallah ta'ala.
What about later on, like the four imams that we discussed last week, and you affirm them all to be from Ahlus-sunnah, do they not differ, like, for example, one of them in particular, in terms of their definition of iman, is that not an asli issue that they differed in with the
Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was mukhti, and he's from the murji'atul fuqaha.
So why does that make him a mubtadi'ah, for example, an innovator?
Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, the thing with his reality is that the scholars, a lot has been transmitted from him, which has no basis. This issue is one of the issues that are clear, that he had that belief, and the scholars, because of that, they categorized him as, murji'atul fuqaha for that belief of iman. And after I mentioned the Quran and the Sunnah, I don't think anyone should justify. See, this is the thing, I've always found it very shocking, hatta even when I was a beginner student of knowledge, and I still am a beginner student of knowledge, is that if a person does a mistake, and these great imams in Islam, you have to understand, when they did mistakes, it wasn't they looked to do mistakes. I want you to understand, they didn't look for those mistakes. It sometimes happened from them. You come, and he was just, if the evidence reached, he would have taken it. That's the reality of those imams. You come, and you, which happens in the madahibs, especially in the madhab al-hanafiyya, that's very common. They make a qa'idah for that mistake of his. They make a qa'idah, a principle for that mistake of his. Instead of just saying it was wrong, and the correct view is this. What do? They justify his mistake, and they say this is correct. Maybe he saw the dalil. Some of them went extreme by saying anything that Abu Hanifa did, which is opposite to the evidence, we do naskh of it, we abrogate it. That extreme. So anyways, the point I'm trying to come to is that the imam is a human being, you can get it right or wrong. Abu Hanifa, these are from the few issues that he has been critiqued on, mas'alatul iman, and I mentioned he went against the ijma', and Imam al-Bukhari went against him on this issue. And by the way, many people don't know, and Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala has a refutation on Imam Abu Hanifa. Walidhalika, the early Hanafiyya didn't like Imam al-Bukhari, had something against him, because he had a risala on the issue of raising your hands when you're praying, and the Hanafiyya don't believe that issue. Reciting of the basmala in the salah, which Al-Imam al-Bukhari wrote a kitab on it. And it was a refutation against them. And so, until very recent, they really were anti-Imam al-Bukhari, the early Hanafiyya. Anyways, ala kulli hal, it's one of those issues he went against Ahlus-Sunnah in.
Okay. I'm going to go into my closing questions now, and I'll give you a chance to summarize what we've discussed today, inshallah. The first question I have is Aqeedah regional? Some people say Saudi Arabia has one Aqeedah and this another part of the world has another Aqeedah. Is that what it's like in reality?
No, actually it's the opposite. An Imam Abu Muzaffar al-Sam'ani, who I mentioned, Shaykh al-Khurasan, Shaykh Shafi'iyah, one of the Shafi'i scholars. By the way, he was about 30 years, he was a Hanafi, and then he left the Hanafi madhab and he became a Shafi'i for 20 years. He wrote a kitab called Qawatu' al-Adillah. And there's another kitab called Al-Intisari Ashab al-Hadith. He mentions there that wherever you travel in the world and you meet the people of Hadith, they speak the same. And that's the reality. Wallah, you go to India and you meet the person of Salafi, Ahlus-Sunnah, Ahl-Hadith. I met them and I was taken back. I was like, Akhi, wallah, Allahumma barik. You go to the UK, you meet them, they're the same. You go to America, they're the same. You go to Africa, you meet them, they're the same. You go to Somalia, they're the same. So, if you're sincere and you're honest, you'll always realize
okay. They
are the same wherever they are.
Okay, next question I have is, and you touched on this very briefly during the podcast, why have the majority of the scholars in the history of Islam been from the Asha'ira?
That, by that statement, that the Asha'ira are the majority of the people, through the podcast, I've proven it. The statement of Ibn Abdul Bar I brought, Khwarizmindat al-Misri, he brought that the Malikiyah, he says.
You said through the podcast I've proven it. You mean through the podcast you've disproven it, that statement, that the Asha'ira are the majority?
Yeah, I've proven that the Asha'ira are not the majority.
Not the majority.
Yeah, uh-huh. Or disprove their argument.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So the Asha'ira are, this statement, by the way, that ashaa'ira, the majority, and they being the majority, is a claim Subki came with. It's a kitab called, it's called Mu'idun Ni'am wa Mubidun Niqam, something like that. Okay? And in that book, he mentioned that. And then they all took it on board. If I go through some of the names of the great scholars of Al-Islam, Abul Hasan Ash'ari was a what, Shafi'i, right? He's a Shafi'i, right? I'm just going to mention within the Shafi'i madhab. I won't go to the Malikiyah. I can do that in the Maliki madhab. I can go to Ibn Abd al-Barr. I can go to Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani. I can go to Khwizm ibn Dad and what do you call it? Other Imams of the Maliki madhab. Just stick to the Shafi'i madhab. Just the Shafi'i madhab, just to show you within the Shafi'i madhab that there is more Ahlus-sunnah than there are the Asha'ira. So I'm going to mention 22 names from the Shafi'i madhab alone who had a big, significant role. This madhab of Imam Shafi'uni, who was a'immatu sunnah within the Shafi'i madhab, who either studied with Imam Shafi'i or who studied with the students of Shafi'i. First one is Al-Imam Abu Bakr, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Al-Qurashi Al-Humaydi Al-Makki, who died in 219. He has a kitab where he talks about the Aqeedah Ahl-Sunnah. It's called Usul I'tiqad Ahl-Sunnah. He studied from Al-Imam Shafi'i, Tabaqatul Ula, the first students of Al-Imam Shafi'i. And he even traveled with him to Egypt and he studied with him there. So he has a kitab called Usul Sunnah. Many people study it. I've taught it and it's online. The second imam is Abu Ya'qub Yusuf ibn Yahya al-Qurashi al-Buwaiti, who died in 231. And he's considered min khawas al-tullab al-imam al-Shafi'i. ولذلك Shafi'i said about him, ليس أحد أحق بمجلسي من يوسف ibn Yahya. And Imam Shafi'i said, there's no one who deserves to be occupying my seat, Shafi'i saying this, other than Abu Ya'qub al-Buwaiti. And he said, وَلَيْسَ أَحَدُ مِنْ أَصْحَابِي أَعْلَمُ مِنْهُ. And Shafi'i said, there's no one more knowledgeable than him. And his aqidah and his position regarding the issue of خلق القرآن is well known. And he was killed for this issue. He died in prison because of the issue of خلق القرآن. The third one is Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani. It's the second student, third student I'm going to mention. I mentioned Abu Bakr al-Humaydi, Abdullah ibn Zubayr. I mentioned Abu Ya'qub al-Buwaiti. Now I mentioned Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, who died in 264 Hijriah. He authored the kitab, Sharh al-Sunnah, that we took in our Dawrah. He's a student of Shafi'i. The fourth one is Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Umar ibn Suraj. He's also a virtuous person. His aqeedah in sunnah is well known. Ibn al-Qayyib brought it all in his Ijtima' al-Juyush al-Islamiyyah. The fifth one is Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Ishaq ibn Khuzaymah. He has a kitab called Kitab al-Tawheed, and he also has a kitab al-Sifat. Number six is Abu Mansur Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Azhari, who died in 370 Hijriah. He's a alim jalil. He has a kitab called Tahdhib al-Lugha, which Nawawi worked on. The seventh one is Abu Bakr Ahmad ibn Ibrahim al-Isma'ili. He has a kitab called I'tiqad A'immat al-Hadith. He's a faqih, he's an imam min fuqaha al-Shafi'iyyah. ولذلك حافظ ابن كثير said about him, الفقيه الإمام الحافظ أحد كبراء الشافعية فقها وحديث وتصنيفا. Number eight is الإمام أحمد ابن أبي طاهر أبو حامد الإسرائيلي, who died in 406 Hijriya. I told you about him. ابن كثير, and he said about him, شيخ الشافعية بلا مدافع. He's a شيخ الشافعية without any argumentation. Until he was said, he is الشافعي الثاني. Okay, ابن كثير said this. And I told you he's been أصحاب الوجوه. He is min ashab al-wujuh. Number nine is al-imam al-alam al-shahir Abu al-Qasim Hibatullahi ibn al-Hasan ibn Mansur al-Raziyu. He's known as al-Lalaka'iyu. He's a kitab called Sharh Usul I'tiqad Ahli Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. And he's considered from the a'immatu al-Shafi'iyya. Ibn al-Qayyim said about him, ahadu a'immatu ashab al-Shafi'i. Al-imam Abu al-Qasim Sa'ad ibn Ali al-Zanjani. He's a ra'iyya in aqidah. Abdul Razak al-Badr explained it. He's called al-Qasidah al-Ra'iyya. His aqidah is documented in there, and it's shocking because he talks about Allah's names and attributes. Number 11, Al-Imam Abu Mudaffar Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Sam'ani, who died in 489 Hijriah. Subki said about him, أحد أئمة الدنيا الرفيع القدر العظيم المحمل المشهور الذكر أحد من طبق الأرض ذكره وطبق الكون نشره. Dhahabi said about him, ta'assaba li ahli al-hadith wa sunnah wal jama'ah. He was very strong. His passion was for the people of hadith and sunnah. Wa kana shawqan fi a'yun al-mukhalifin wa hujjatu li ahli sunnah. Dhahabi said about him, he was a thorn in the necks of the people of innovation, and he was a proof for the people of hadith. He's got a kitab qawatu' al-adilla, and there's another kitab called al-intisar li ashab al-hadith, worth reading. Number 12, Al-Imam Abu Muhammad Al-Husayn Ibn Mas'ud Al-Baghawi, who died 516 Hijriya, Ibn Al-Qayyim said, Tafsiruhu shaja fi huluq al-mu'attilat wal-jahmiya. His tafsir book, Ma'alim al-Tanzil, wallahi, it's a thorn in the neck of the innovators. He has another kitab, Kushar Hussunnah. It's worth reading. Number 13 is Al-Imam Abu Nu'aym Ubaidullah Ibn Al-Hasan Ibn Ahmad Al-Asbahani, who died 517. Okay, he's real well known as Ibn Haddad. Okay, Ibn al-Qayyim mentions his Aqeedah in his kitab Ijtima'u Jush al-Islamiyya. Number 14, Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan Muhammad ibn Abdul Malik al-Karji, who died in 532 Hijriya. Ibn Dhahabi mentions his Aqeedah in his kitab Al-Ulu, and he mentions some of it. Number 15, Al-Imam Qawam al-Sunnah Ismail ibn Muhammad al-Taymiyyu al-Shafi'iyyu. He's the author of the kitab Al-Targhib al-Tarhib, and a kitab called Al-Hujjah fi Bayan al-Mahajjah. Wallahi, that book is powerful. Number 16, and I referenced a lot of it. The next one is Al-Imam Abu Zakariya Yahya ibn Ibrahim al-Salmani. He died 550 Hijriya. Number 17 is Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan Yahya ibn Abi al-Khayr al-Imrani. He has a kitab called Al-Intisaru fi al-Raddi ala al-Qadariyyati al-Ashrar. I was going to quote some of it from him, but I left it because of time. And he's one of the people, he has a sharah, he's got a kitab called Al-Bayan, where he also explains Al-Muhadhab al-Ishaq al-Shirazi. You know, he quotes him a lot. Number 18 is Majduddin Abu al-Fadail Yusuf ibn Muhammad al-Dimashqi. He also has a qasida in the sunnah. Number 19, Al-Shaykh Abdul Qahir ibn Abdul Wahid ibn Muhammad al-Tibrizi, who died 740 Hijriya, and he is Shuyukh al-Hafidh al-Dhahabi, and he has Aqeedah also. Number 20 is Al-Imam Shamsuddin Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Uthman al-Dhahabi, who died 748 Hijriya. He has a kitab called Al-Ulu li-Ali al-Ghaffar, where he wants to prove Allah is above his throne. Dhahabi. Hafil Imaduddin Abu al-Fida Ismail ibn Kathir, who died 774. He has a tafsir kitab, and he's got Al-Bidai wa Nihaya. Look at his tafsir and how he looks at Allah's names and attributes. Number 22 is Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Ali al-Maqrizi al-Misri, who died 845 Hijriya. He has a kitab called Tajrid al-Tawheed al-Mufid. All of those scholars I mentioned, they were a'imah. Are we going to look at Sha'ira as those four people that we mentioned? Baqilani?
There were others amongst them as well, right?
To say Bayjuri and Laqani, to say that they're the majority, another thing is, which is, whoever connected the truth to numbers. And we can say today, Christian can come to us and say, you guys are not upon truth. We are larger than you guys in number. You guys are upon falsehood. Muslims are little in number. I mean, that argument, Allah says in the Quran, وَإِنْ تُطْعَ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you obey the majority of the people, they will misguide you from the straight path. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. The majority of the people don't know. وَقَلِيلٌ مِنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. So the number is not necessarily a mi'yar, a scaling machine that you can find out who's right or who's wrong. That being said though, again, that claim I told you, it goes back to Subki, who claimed it, and Subki is Ash'ari himself. So he's muta'assib Ash'ari. Of course he's going to claim, and everyone took that on board after him. Especially Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari al-Halik. He loves these, he's a very fanatic person. Just for defending an Imam Abu Hanifa, he insulted 300 Imams of Islam. Anas ibn Malik there, Al-Imam Malik, Al-Imam Shafi'i. He slandered Imam Shafi'i's honor by saying Shafi'i is not a Muttalibi. He belittled and he ridiculed Shafi'i's Arabic. Shafi'i is an imam in the Arabic, not in his hujjah. Just for one, and if you narrate one hadith that goes against Abu Hanifa, he will slander you.
Okay, so despite them not being the majority, as your claim is, and this is a claim by Subki, there is still a large number of them. If the truth is so clear cut, so black and white, Shahid, how did all these imams get misguided like
Shahid, this? Why do they always call themselves Shafi'iyun and then ash'ariyun. Why do they say ana shafi'iyun ash'ariyun fil i'tiqad? They say ana shafi'iyu shar'a. Ama ana shafi'iyun, they say ana shafi'iyu shar'a ash'ariyu li'tiqad. Or I am shafi'iyun fil furu'. Shafi'iyun fil furu'. Ash'ariyu fil i'tiqad. So you're not happy with Imam Shafi'i's i'tiqad? Why don't you just say I'm a Shafi'i? خلاص أخيد Shafi'i. We will. Do you see my point? And somebody say أنا حنبلي في الفروع معتزلي في الأصول. They say that. And that shows that these imams were not that. Hence, before what I told you, Al Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, one of the reasons why he left the belief of the Mu'tazila was what? I'm a Shafi'i and I'm going against my imam in issues of i'tiqad. It never made sense to him.
So then how do you end up with someone like Imam An-Nawawi, for example, who was Shafi'i, but then also Ash'ari, as they claim?
Saying an Imam Ibn Hajar and an Imam An-Nawawi are Ash'ariya is a kidman, it's a lie.
How can...
Because what I just mentioned to you is Ash'ari believe the Qur'an is makhluq. Nawawi didn't believe that. Wala Ibn Hajar never believed that. One of the fundamental beliefs of the Asha'ira today is mas'alat al-taqlid fi al-i'tiqad. I'm a taqlid fi al-tawheed. You can't do taqlid in tawheed, right? So what do you do in tawheed? We believe that, but we don't believe in the same way. They believe that taqlid in tawheed means the person has to come with another al-i'tibar. The person needs to look at himself first. That's what they say. And then he makes his way up. He looks at the sky. By the way, I need, inshallah ta'ala, if Allah gives me another chance, Asha'ira believe amatul nas, the people are all kuffar. They're takfiriyun in that issue. You have to remember that. Now, but due to time, I can't. I don't like just say something like that and not give them my proofs for it. But anyways, look at Bayjuri Sharah, yani the bait of Laqani. They believe that. Da'amatu nas because they're muqallida. They just take the belief. They didn't do this another wali i'tibar. They didn't look around, look from themselves upwards. They didn't do that. So to them, if you don't do that, you're not a Muslim. You're not what? You're not a Muslim. It's gharib, it's tanaqudat. And iman to them is tasdeeq as well. It's contradicting. The point I'm trying to come to is, the sha'ira, they have this belief called an-nadhar wal-i'tibar. They hold on to it. This is one of their fundamental beliefs. Nawawi in his sharh al-sahih Muslim refutes that. When it comes to hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he goes, the first thing in Islam is ashadu la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Ibn Hajar saying he's an Ash'ari in Lisan al-Mizan. If you go to Ibn Hajar, what did he do? Ibn Hajar, what he did was he came to Fakhruddin al-Razi and he was talking about him. He says, "Awsa bi wasiyatin tadullu ala annahu hassana i'tiqadahu." He said he gave a wasiya, a farewell. Yani Ibn Hajar gave a wasiya. Sorry, Fakhruddin al-Razi gave a wasiya. Ibn Hajar is saying this. He's saying Fakhruddin al-Razi gave a wasiya. Farewell. This farewell is what? Yani that he repented, which is well known that he's repentance. Inshallah, if we get another series on the issue of Allah's name and attributes, I will go into details in there. Inshallah, and the reference and exactly where it's written in. Ibn Hajar is saying Fakhruddin al-Razi gave a wasiyah where he perfected his aqeedah. And I just mentioned Fakhruddin al-Razi is one of the horsemen, and he's one of the forefront imams Ash'ariya, and he's saying that he perfected his aqeedah. Ibn Hajar, he's an Ash'ari according to them. He wouldn't say that about his own imam, unless the Ash'ari aqeedah to Ibn Hajar is not what he... By the way, when you say someone is an Ash'ari, did Ibn Hajar ever claim it? Bring us. I dare them where Ibn Hajar said I am Ash'ari. Or Nawawi said I am Ash'ari. Prove it to me.
Did they say I'm Athari? They say the opposite.
The asal is salama. They're Muslims. They're safe. There's nothing. What we do accept is, though, and it's the reality in front of us, Ibn Hajar and Nawawi both came to some of Allah's names and attributes, and they did. They did do ta'wil of it.
Okay.
There's a difference. I told you this before. A person who doesn't believe the Quran and Sunnah is evidence or proof whatsoever, and comes to Allah's names and attributes with a belief before that, and that the Quran and Sunnah is not a proof in and within itself, which I mentioned, Baqillani statements and Ya'ani Bayjuri and Laqani and all of that. I mentioned this, and Sunusi and what he said. Al-Usul al-Kufr, At-Tamasuk bi-Zawahir al-Nusus. Ibn Hajar believed that. That is from the foundation of Kufr, to hold on to the Quran and the Sunnah.
No, of course not.
That's what Ash'ari believe. The forefront And the card carriers of the Ash'ari is Subki, is well known. Shahrastari, well known. We're not debating these people. Yani Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni, we're not going to debate with you. Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni, yani Ghazali, yani Baqillani, Sa'adidin al-Taftazani, Nufawrak, these are your people, we admit. Lakin Nawawiyu akhta'a, he did mistakes, he did ta'wil of ba'd al-sifat. And an example for this is Mujahid ibn Jabirin, for example. When it came to the ayah Surah Al-Qiyamah, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, he did ta'wil of the Mu'tazila, Mujahid ibn Jabirin. He said, تَنْتَظِرُ ثَوَابَ رَبِّهَا. Has anyone ever attributed Mujahid ibn Jabirin to the Mu'tazila? Anyone ever say that?
No.
And then مجرد, a person does ta'wil of a sifa from a verse, doesn't necessarily mean that they are a what? That they are a Mu'tazili, or that they are Ash'ari. Then, nobody will say that. It's like saying Salafis are Ash'aris right now because we agree with Ash'aira in the issue of the companions.
So you're saying Imam Nawawi fell into mistakes when it came to names and attributes of Allah. Ibn Hajar,
not even unrestrictedly, there are characteristics like Uluwullah, Allah being above his throne. Nawawi, by the way, Nawawi is a risala. I haven't personally come across it. I recently saw a clip, so I don't know the authenticity. I haven't looked into it deeply. I came across a clip of Sheikh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Hamid al-Usaymi mentioning that Nawawi repented from the belief of the Asha'irah. And he what? And he also, he repented from that. And there's a kitab he wrote in his Aqeedah. Now, I haven't read it yet. And it's really, to be honest, the first time I ever heard it. But there is something that I used to see all the time, which kind of shocked me. Which is Ibn Attar, who's a noble student of Nawawi, was not an Ash'ari. And he's the card carrier of Nawawi. He was called Small Nawawi. Spread the works of Nawawi. Why he never became an Ash'ari, that was always on my mind.
Okay. And as for Ibn Hajar, you're saying Fakhruddin al-Razi actually repented from his belief towards the end of his life. And Ibn Hajar said, looked at that repentance, and actually said, now he's perfected his aqidah.
Yeah, and it's, when you look at them, they speak about ash'ari as an entity that stands. وَقَالَ الْأَشَاعِرَ. That's what they say.
Yeah.
But they don't refer to themselves as ash'ari when they have the opportunity.
Okay, my next question is, and I'll make this the final question, inshallah. I think the final question was, Halil Ash'ara min Ahlus-sunnah, but I think we're well past that point. So I think I will leave it to you to summarize what we've discussed today, inshallah, and then we'll close it there.
Wallahi, there's so much to say. I don't think we'll summarize. I'd go back to the podcast, watch it detailed, take your notes. That's my advice to the brothers and sisters. This is a deen, and so take your time, look at it. Ash'ara didn't spread because of Ya'ani, they're the haq and every Ahlus-sunnah are the batil. No, they spread because of political reasons as well. There were political reasons why they spread. Like for example, Muhammad Nuruddin al-Zanki, rahimahullah ta'ala, was a fair and a just ruler. He placed Ibn Asakir and gave him Darul Hadith in Damascus and said, teach. And he's the author of the kitab Tabiyun al-Kadhib al-Muftari fi ma nusiba ila al-imam Abi al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. There are also external other factors that helped him and supported them in becoming, you know, in power and becoming seen as the Ahlus-Sunnah. Not necessarily because they are Ahlus. Again, what helped them was that the fact they concealed their belief. I told you what Ibn Qudama said about them. Bayjuri himself, what do you say when it comes to Allah's names? There's like, we already say this in private circles when we're teaching students. Also, the fact that they came out to refute the Mu'tazila. And at that moment, no one was out there to be refuted other than the Mu'tazila. The whole heat was on the Mu'tazila. So when they came out and they refuted the Mu'tazila, everybody saw them to be min Ahli Sunnah. And that's why they deceived the Ummah. And for a long time, it was silence, and they spread until the people woke up to them and realized, what are these people? What do they believe? And their corrupt belief was seen. And Allah brought Shaykh al-Islam, Ahmad ibn Abdul Halim ibn Taymiyyah al-Harrani, and he destroyed them, their foundations, shake them, They imprisoned him. They tried to silence him. But he really refuted them deeply. And Ibn al-Qayyim came and never left nothing for him. And when Ibn Taymiyyah wrote his Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aqli wal-Naql, and that book came out, يعني, that was it. Fakhruddin was their imam, Imam al-A'zam. And now he got refuted. Ibn al-Qayyim summarized that book in his Sawa'iq al-Mursala. It's a summary. Sawa'iq al-Mursala is a summary of Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aqli wal-Naql. A talib ilmu qari Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aqli wal-Naql should read it. Sawa'iq al-Mursala. By the way, Sawa'iq al-Mursala is not actually finished. It's not complete. So it's better just read the Mukhtasar Sawa'iq al-Mursala.
Right.
So inshallah ta'ala.
I think it's been a very eye-opening discussion for many people, inshallah wa ta'ala. Barakallahu feek for joining me. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.